Hello. Now, before we start today's episode, I just needed to give you a little warning, which is I was a little bit of a muppet when we recorded this week's episode, and my microphone was on a little bit too high. So unfortunately, I sound a little bit distorted throughout today's episode. So I just thought I'd say sorry about that. All right, on with today's episode.
Hello and welcome to James Bond Radio. This is episode 109. My name is Chris Wright and with me is my good pal and fellow Bond mad nutcase, Mr. Thomas Ears. How are you, Tom?
I'm doing very well, mate. I'm doing very well. I'm excited about two things today. Would you like to know what they are?
I would, yes. Well, have you got a new pair of underpants?
I do, at long last. But secondly to that, we've only got Gloria Hendry on the show today, which is pretty amazing. Thanks to roving reporter Matthew Chernov, all the way from Los Angeles. She's going to make a little appearance on the show a little bit later. And I'm also excited about Mi6 Mailbag number 4, because it escaped my mind that we hadn't done one of these episodes until April of this year. So it's been a while since we've done it. To anyone who doesn't know, Mi6 Mailbag is obviously listener questions. So exciting times.
Yeah, definitely. That's strange because I know we planned to do one sort of a while ago and then we went on holiday for a bit.
Yeah.
And then we came back and we're going to do one and then Roger Moore popped up. So,
He got in the way, didn't he, old Sir Roger?
He did. Yeah, he did. So mailbag episode. What we've done, we compiled all the questions. We've had loads of great questions. So we compiled them into various bits and pieces. And we've got a couple of little tweaks to some of the quiz stuff, which we're going to talk to you about later on as well, which is obviously exciting stuff. So, I was just trying to think, has there been any Bond news in terms of the world of Bond 25? Do you know what's strange, Tom?
Go on.
Since Danny Boy did his interview at the New Yorker Festival, it's all gone quiet, hasn't it? Everyone's kind of gone, oh, hang on a minute. Where are all these people now saying, oh, it could be him and him and him? Ever since that interview, everything's died down a little bit, hasn't it? What do you think?
Yeah, and it's something we sort of said all along, didn't we? We put out a blog post, didn't we, a few weeks ago over on jamesbondradio.com talking about it. And it's kind of the number one thing we've always said is, keep your eye on Daniel's schedule. And as soon as what other things he's shooting impinge on the time that they would shoot Bond 25, then there's the signal that he's probably not going to come back. But, there was all that nonsense in the press. And then in his New Yorker interview the other week, he basically said, if I were to stop, then I would really miss it. So there you go, from the horse's mouth. He's not quit.
And
he's
saying it's the best job in the world.
Yeah, and all that kind of stuff. That stuff about slashing the wrists, it drives me mad seeing that quote left, right and centre, because it was so taken out of context. So yeah, he's coming back. And as well, when you look at like the climate these days, when you look at films coming out left, right and centre, they're all sequels or remakes. There's very few films that come out that are like original things, because that's where they make the money these days. And with the money that Daniel brings him with Bond, there is no way they will let him go anytime soon. I feel like he's going to come back. He'll be good for one more film.
Yeah.
But if they really push it, he can possibly come back for two, I think. I don't know.
I think one is definitely in the bag. Two, like you said, I'm not sure. But you said something to me earlier today, which got me quite excited. And it was the fact that we're going to start to get some little nuggets of Bond 25 soon. There's going to be little rumours, but I mean proper rumours. I don't mean who's going to be Bond, whatever. We're going to start to get, I think I've heard the Bond film crew scouting locations in South Africa or wherever it might be, And that could be quite exciting when we start to sort of hear stuff like that.
Well, that's it. So on the day we're recording this is the 26th of October, right? Which is the 1 year anniversary of the premiere of Spectre that we obviously got tickets to. Thanks again, Rory Cooper. I love you.
I love you too.
So that's a year ago and time flies. I wish I could be, back 1 year ago today and be experiencing that for the first time and all that kind of stuff. But it makes me think, okay, a year's gone by. That means in all likelihood, Bond 25 is going to come out in roughly 2 years' time, which means the next year from now is going to be the year where all the pre-production is starting to kick in and all that little stuff and all the little newsy nuggets are going to start little sort of drip feeding out over time and stuff. And then the year after that is obviously when the film will be in production. And then that's when it all kicks into high gear and stuff. So like from now onwards, I feel like what's going to happen is at the beginning of 2017, like when we hit January, that's roughly the sort of time we're going to see a little nugget or two kind of just drop into our ear holes. What do you think?
Yeah, I reckon definitely. I think between now and Christmas, probably you're not going to hear much. But once we get into the new year, particularly around Easter onwards, it's going to really start to happen. So, yeah. I mean, we had so much fun in the build-up to Spectre, didn't we? Getting all these sort of little things. And that title reveal where you pissed yourself, that was brilliant. So we got that to look forward to, which is cool. Yeah, just looking at other sort of Bond news then, there's been quite a lot in the sort of literary world of Bond. I don't know if we mentioned last time, but Steve Cole, we found out, he's only doing 4 young Bond books. So he's doing one less than Higson. But his last and fourth young Bond is going to be called Red Nemesis. Now, that's a pretty cool title. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I've just literally this last week finished reading Heads You Die. It took me a little while to get through it. Not because because of the book. It was just because I was busy doing stuff. So it took me a little while to actually get through it. But I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I've said it before, like the thing with Shoot to Kill, which I saw a lot of people said, is like the setting of LA and stuff and the film business wasn't a particularly Bond-esque feeling kind of setting, which I can understand. Whereas this is set in Cuba, you know, proper like Caribbean waters. It proper has that old school Fleming-y kind of, you know, it belongs to that world, which is wicked. Yeah. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I tell you what like, I feel like he stepped up his game for the second book, and it's like the name of the villain is great. Like all the little ingredients you need to make a good Bond story, he's got in there. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Yeah,
I'm literally towards the end of that book, and I've just got to the point. I'm not going to say anything because of the spoilers, but basically, it's a classic villain's lair. So I'm literally at that point. So I'm close to the end, and I've really enjoyed it as well. Thoroughly enjoyed it. So obviously, straight after that, we can get on with Strike Lightning, which will be cool. And I think Red Nemesis is due summer next year. Is that right? I think it's something like that, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's crazy, isn't it? How he's just fired out 2 books in the same year, like literally a few months apart, and then his last one's coming next year. So I'm interested to see what happens next, in the sense that. So they originally wanted Higson to come back and write more, but he was, you know, he wanted to focus on I think he's got a zombie series of books that he writes.
That's right.
He wanted to focus on that. And he said he did want to come back. He just, you know, he wanted to get that done first. So it'll be interesting to see what happens after Steve Cole does his fourth, whether that Higson will come back and then do another set of books, or they'll get somebody new completely. It'll be interesting to see. Yeah. It'll be interesting to see what happens for sure. But in other literary news, Anthony Horowitz is coming back for another Bond book. How do you feel about that?
Which is cool. I'm really chuffed with that. I know you're a big fan of Solo, and I did like Solo as well, but in all honesty, I think Trigger Mortis is probably my favourite of the recent sort of follow-on authors. Yeah, I think I really enjoyed it. I thought it was superb. Yeah, I like the whole rocket setting and the car racing and everything like that. And yeah, there is that castle that he went to. Do you remember, just over the water? And I saw a photo of you and your missus, and there was a castle, and it looked exactly like the one described in the book. I thought that was
a little
really cool.
Sort of tower out, and it was over in Lisbon. Yeah. There's like a little tower castle thing, and since you said that, I was like, oh yeah, it does look like it. But so apparently it's going to include more unused Fleming material, so that's an interesting little thing. Yeah. And I'm curious to see where it's going to be set, whether it's going to almost carry on from Trigger Mortis, or whether it's going to be sandwiched between 2 other Fleming stories, or whether it's going to come in its own little pocket. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how it plays
that is true. Well, I don't think this one is going to be released until, I think they said spring 2018. So we've got a little while. I'm assuming he's probably hardly started working on it. So we might get a bit more information sort of later into next year as well. But again, it'll be interesting to see where the setting. And I'm assuming it's still going to be Bond in his peak, you know, kind of as he was. But as to where it is or where it ends up, exciting times. So that's really cool. Also, I guess in literary news as well, Dynamite Comics have just released their new 6-part series, Hammerhead. Now, that got released, I think it was about two couple of weeks ago now. And in all honesty, I really need to sort of move my ass on the comic book side of things, because I've not had a chance. I know Jack Lugo's done some wicked blogs on it, and I've had a good read of those, which are cool. But I think I'm going to have to get into them at some point. I think it's a case where, because I've got all these other books to get through, all the other Bond books and stuff, I've kind of just put it off, because I know that even if I had it on my bedside table, I wouldn't read it right now. So that's kind of why the reason. I think it's going to get to the stage where I've done the Steve Cole's, you know, 1 or 2 other books, and then suddenly I just get a stack of them and just work my way through them. But that might not be until sort of later in the year. But there we go.
It is tough, man. I've got so many books in the queue to get through and so little time. It's a tough one to kind of get everything done, isn't it? But there you go. Cool stuff. So obviously in music related news. Good old Cue the Music, which obviously you did a podcast with Warren last week, didn't you? The first of the Music of Bond podcasts, which went really well. Everybody seemed to really dig that, which was good. Oh, Warren's a natural at the old podcasting, isn't he? He's got a very smooth sounding voice.
He has indeed. And it was really nice to interview Nick Rain as well. He was a good guy to get on board for sure.
Yeah. So Cue the Music, obviously, if you don't know yet, are playing at the Harlington Theatre in Fleet on November 27th. So just under a month away. And it is going to sell out. Warren's been keeping us adrift. What's the word I'm looking for? Adrift is the wrong word. He's been keeping us abreast.
Updated? I don't know.
Updated.
Abreast. Abreast. It's got to be.
He's been keeping us abreast of the ticket sales, and it's basically going to sell out any day, basically. So there's a huge number of JBR family members going, including you. You're going to be hosting the live stream,
going to be taking
people backstage and all that kind of business. So even if you're miles away from Fleet and you can't make it, make sure you head over to the Cue the Music website, which is cuethemusicshow.com, and you can find details of their kind of live stream and how you can tune into that and all that kind of business, which will be good. So that's November 27th, the Harlington in Fleet. If you want to get tickets, go to theharlington.co.uk to do that. And there's a Facebook group as well now for anybody that's going, isn't there?
That's right. Yeah, we set that up a week or two ago. If anyone who's interested in coming along, just basically type in James Bond Radio, Cue the Music Show, and you should find the Facebook page, or just let us know. And we might post it on the website as well, and then people can have an easy link to it. There's already, like you said, like at least 12, 15 people going, if not more, in terms of from the JBR lot, maybe even 20 plus at the moment. So, yeah, anyone that's interested, get on down. It'll be good to see everyone there for sure.
Good stuff. Now, I tell you what really warms my cockles, mate. What really warms my cockles is when I see JBR family members out there in the field, so to speak, enjoying themselves. And this week we got a little video, didn't we, come through on the Facebook from the JBR Philly group. There's like a little local chapter of JBR listeners from Philadelphia in the US, obviously. And they've done a little field trip over to Vegas to do some Diamonds Are Forever. I imagine there'll be some gambling involved as well, but to, you know, primarily go and check out some Diamonds Are Forever locations. So big shout out to Colin Henderson, Holly Price, Bob Brodsky Jr. and Felix Kukuru, if I've pronounced that correctly. Like the fact that there was a Felix on the team. That pleases me. And they made a little live stream video of them playing the water balloon game, which is still there from Diamonds Are Forever, which kind of still blows my mind even. And they're even sporting their JBR t-shirts as well, so they were out representing in the Vegas. It was brilliant.
It was great to see, man. I loved seeing the water balloons and each trying to sort of outdo each other, and they won quite a few prizes but no diamonds apparently, which is a shame. They obviously checked, you know, took away the eye of whatever Teddy or whatever they want. But it looked like they had a banging time, and that is awesome. So, good stuff, JBR Philly. Speaking of actually JBR groups, we've got a couple of new ones which have started off pretty recently. There's JBR Baltimore, which is one of the new ones, JBR Washington, D.C., and over in the UK, we've got JBR South Coast Central. So if anyone is in any of those areas, let us know. And there will be a JBR New York group set up pretty soon as well, as I'm sure that's in the works at the moment.
That's so it. So if you're local to any one of those, you can just type into the old Facebook search, JBR Washington, D.C. or whatever it is, and then you should find the page and you can join it and you can hang out with some other like-minded local people, which will be lovely. Yeah. And of course, if there isn't a group for your area, then start one. Just get in touch with us over the Facebook and you can set up your own local chapter of Bond people, which will be good. Good plan. Absolutely.
We list them all on the website as well, so if you want to have a look and check out and see if yours is on there, just go to jameswarmradio.com, and there's a little bit down the right, isn't there, where it's join your local JBR group, and you click on that and then you can see who is there.
So speaking of the blog, Chris, what's been happening over there lately?
So we had a really cool piece from Matthew Grice Pants. He's done, I think he's doing a two-part review of the video games of James Bond. So this is part one. And he's gone right back to the early days where you're looking at these dodgy little pixels. You can't quite make it out, you know, right to the early sort of games of Bond, up till the classic, the unbelievable classic GoldenEye on the N64. So he's gone through that sort of timeline to look at all the different Bond games that have been released. And it's really interesting, actually, because looking back, I remember playing some really early days. And, I don't know, I remember there were some that were released and I just didn't get around to playing them for whatever reason. And now I'm a little bit gutted because obviously nowadays there are so, there have been quite a lot, haven't there, in the last, what, 10 years or something. So it'd be quite interesting to revisit some of that.
Absolutely. And that's a sort of area of things, kind of like the comic books, that you and I aren't that knowledgeable about, you know, isn't it? So there's a lot of, I know a lot of JBR listeners who are big time gamers and stuff who've been saying, you should do an episode on the games. And it's like, well, we don't really know enough about them, to be honest, to sort of do it. But I remember being a kid and I remember playing one for A View to a Kill, which was just like the most ridiculous little stick figure man running around. And I remember there was a level where the sort of the bomb would go down into that sort of big cave where all the like explosives was all laid around. I remember that. And I remember a Living Daylights one, which was like a side scrolling game, which again, the graphics were ridiculous, but you would shoot things. And then I think my favorite one from that era was the License to Kill one. I remember that. And there was like a top down section where you were like running along and it was, it was like a bird's eye view down and you'd run along and like hide behind cars and shoot and stuff. And there were all sorts of different levels. I remember loving that as a kid, but then obviously GoldenEye is a classic, but other than that, I'm not too well versed in it really.
Yeah. No, it's interesting though, and I think we had one when we went to on the event recently to Julian O'Hare's James Bond man cave. I think I mentioned it before. You had this arcade with an old style James Bond game, but now you can look back on it with a bit of sort of nostalgia, and you don't care if it's crap because it's James Bond, so you still give it a go.
Until
your mind kind of warps, and then you kind of go, okay, I'll move on now. Yeah. But there we are. So I mentioned in the last podcast as well about a potential JBR meetups coming up. So there's obviously a big one, which we're going abroad next year, doing Operation Chateau Hand, which I may have mentioned. And there may be a fourth chateau involved. That's something that I'm working on. But now that's not until sort of first weekend in July, so it's still a while away. So we were talking about other JBR meetups and locations, and we're doing a pre-Christmas meetup, which is called... Are you ready, Tom?
I am.
It's called Operation London's Calling. Now,
very nice. Where are you going? Where is it? Where's it
going to
be?
We are going to the Big Smoke. Is London still called the Big Smoke?
I suppose New York is the Big Apple, so London is probably the Big Smoke, isn't it? Yeah.
The Big Smoke. There we are. So we're going to the capital, the big capital. Now, obviously, there's so many locations there. We're not going to be able to fit in everything because there's just too many to fit in over the weekend. We're going over Saturday the 10th and Sunday the 11th of December. And during that time, we're going to cram in as many sort of Skyfall, Spectre locations. We're going to be looking at the pre-titles, locations of The World Is Not Enough with the boat chase and stuff like that. College of Arms from Majesties, various other sort of bits and pieces.
You tell me you're going to Lazenby Lamppost. You've got to do that, haven't you?
We've got to do Lazenby Lamppost, We're going to make sure there's lots of cameras at the ready. Everyone can get their best Lazenby poses on the go. I mean, every time you go to London, you basically have to do Lazenby Lamppost. That's kind of like an unwritten rule, really, isn't it? For sure, yeah. But there are a couple of optional extras installed.
Ooh.
Now, we will be visiting Rawls Restaurant as seen in Spectre. Now, I know a couple of the JBR family have been there before, and it is exquisite. The food is amazing, to die for. And obviously, you'll be eating in the same restaurant that we see in Spectre, so that's really cool. But one very, very special thing, which we've arranged, is we're going to be doing the ultimate spy experience on the RIB powerboat craft going down the Thames.
Very nice.
So basically, this is going to be a whole hour of us in a powerboat. We're going to be passing stuff like the City Hall from Spectre, the O2 Millennium Dome from World Is Not Enough, various other sites we've seen before. We're going to have bomb music blaring at the same time. There's going to be like quizzes and everything like this. And there are going to be points where it really opens up and lets rip along the Thames once you get past the sort of, you know, the speed limit type thing. So how cool is that? So there's going to be... It's maximum of 12 people.
Mm-hmm.
So it is limited to 12 people. Although they do have more than one boat. So if we get, you know, more than that sort of amount of people, we can obviously look into getting another boat. And how cool is that?
So on that boat trip, will you be going into that little underground sort of bit where Q has his little lab?
Do you know what? I'd absolutely love to. But I found out that it's done digitally. So the part on the Thames is like there's no entrance at all. And that actual entrance is Camden Lock, way up by Camden Town. Right. So yeah, obviously it's Cinema Chicory, but I would have loved that. And even if they said no, I probably would have jumped off and swam to go under it just to give
see
it a
if
look.
He's still but, down there tinkering with his gadgets.
That's it. Yeah, he might be. So, yeah, so lots to look forward to for Operation London's Calling. And good again, we're going to have like a Facebook page on it. So if anyone's interested, get in touch and you can find out more details on there.
Good stuff. So, yeah, so basically just come to the James Bond Radio Facebook page and I'm sure you'll be able to find some details on there. We'll throw up a little blog post on the site as well so you know all the details, because you've got a list of locations as long as your arm there, haven't you, Chris? So
you can find
out all the little spots that everybody will be going to. And they're always good fun, those meetups, aren't they?
Yeah, it's great fun. Like last time we had, when we went for a drive in the country, that was great. And we had a little bit of reenactment going on. Mm. So I think we might try to sneak in one or two little scenes that we could possibly film. If not, we'll definitely get a good few stills. We're working on some potential costumes as we speak.
Lovely. That sounds great. That sounds bloody amazing. Good stuff. So before we move on then, obviously we're going to courtesy of a JBR sort of roving reporter, Matthew Chernov over in LA. We have the special guest of Gloria Hendry on the show. Only a little snippety because she was basically performing a concert over in LA and he managed to grab her for a few minutes afterwards. So just a little snippet, but we'll be playing that for you in a bit. But before we get there, Chris, one thing we must mention is obviously we had a very special guest on the show last time, didn't we? We had the one and only Sir Roger Moore, which was a big deal for us, wasn't it?
It was.
Now, what was great about that is the downloads went absolutely through the roof. So I imagine if that was your first episode of JBR that you've ever listened to, welcome aboard. I hope you've enjoyed your stay and you're enjoying listening through to some of the back catalogue. Because the interesting thing we found was Roger's episode was like thousands upon thousands of downloads. And then loads of the early episodes went right up as well. So it looks like some people discovered JBR through the Roger Moore and then went right back to the beginning and are kind of working their way through. So to any of those people, we salute you, because goodness gracious me, that is quite the undertaking that you've undertook of yourself. But for us as well, which is pretty cool, we actually sort of shot up the iTunes charts a little bit, didn't we? We got up to number 8 in the TV and film category on iTunes, which is pretty cool. So
nearly
do you feel more
made
famous?
007. Nearly made
007. That was not quite. Like, come on, just a few more downloads. But we made it to 008. But yeah. We nearly got there. So do you feel more famous now that that's happened, Chris? Are people stopping you in the streets? Have you got groupies knocking down your door or what? What's going on?
I can't really get to work anymore. It's been chaotic. So I've had to go in disguise. And even then, people kind of follow you. But, you know, you kind of get used to that sort of thing after a while. So, you know, I just...
It's a struggle, man. It's the burden that you have to carry the torch of Bond, I think. It's just one of those
things. It's the amount
of
women as well, isn't it? Like, I think George had a similar problem, didn't he? He's no worse.
He didn't. God bless him. Yeah. God bless him. Good stuff. So before we chat to Gloria, then make sure you come and follow our Facebook page. Just put James Bond Radio into the Facebook search, and you'll find us. Come and follow us on Twitter, which is at James Bond Radio. Something a little new for JBR is Periscope. Basically, we're doing some kind of live chats and all that kind of stuff. Every now and then, we'll just jump on for half an hour or something, do a live stream chat where we can, you know, do a bit of Q&A or chat about whatever. And there's also the backlog of videos we've done before. So when we went to the Pinewood Bond Stars event, we did loads of live streaming that day. And we were chatting to Madeline Smith on there and giving people a bit of the tour around the gardens over the live stream and all that kind of stuff. And so you can see those in the sort of archive on Periscope. And we don't have those videos anywhere else. So make sure you download Periscope to your phone and follow us on there at James Bond Radio. You can also follow at Cue the Music Show as well, because good old Wazza started doing a bit of live Bond music Q&A-ing action himself. So make sure you follow those dudes. That's at Cue the Music Show as well. Come and get involved with that. Obviously, come over to jamesbondradio.com, where Jack Lugo is our resident blogmaster. We've got loads of Bond-related stuff for you to read over there. Obviously, there's the comments area as well. You can get stuck into some lovely scintillating conversation on there. And of course, there's iTunes as well. So come and join us on iTunes and subscribe through there as well, so you never miss an episode. And that really helps us to kind of rank higher in the charts and all that kind of stuff and attract more listeners and all that kind of business. And obviously, last but not least, there's a little donate page over on jamesbondradio.com if you want to help keep the good ship JBR afloat. That's always appreciated, but never demanded. So there we go. That's my spiel over with. It's getting gradually longer with all the little different bits involved.
It is, but isn't it?
I made it through, didn't I?
It's going to be as long as a podcast, so
I'm going to make you do it next time and see how you go. But there we go. So in a slight change to programming, we have a big old kind of backlog of listener trivia questions, don't we? So we thought rather than you and I have to kind of go through and compose a new question each week, we thought, well, let's let the listeners take over for a little while and we'll have the listener trivia question of the day. So what have you got for us today then, Chris?
I like that. I think that's a good idea. We were, because it is difficult sometimes just coming up with lots of different trivia. We've obviously done 109 episodes worth, which is certainly a fair amount. So the trivia question that we got today is from William Robertson. And William Robertson's question is, are you ready, Tom?
I am ready.
In which Bond films do we see a pool or snooker table? Now, that question again, in which Bond films do we see a pool or snooker table? Now, that's a really interesting one.
That is an really interesting one. Because I tell you what, when I think of like the green bays of a pool table or a snooker table, I start picturing the casino scenes, which obviously wouldn't be appropriate. That's obviously going to be card tables.
That's a good point.
So there's one in mind that I can think of. But that's a tough question. Not one that immediately sort of jumps into mind. But I've got one from I assume there probably is one because of the setting.
Yeah.
But I couldn't tell you for sure.
No. Well, that's good. It's going to be a thinker. But we'll see how many we can come up with. He didn't tell us how many there actually are, so we don't know. So we'll just sort of see how many we can get, I guess, and then go from there.
Absolutely. Good stuff. Cool. All right, then. So should we... Well, we had Sir Roger last week, didn't we? So should we have one of his first Bond girls on the show? Should we say hello to Gloria Hendry?
Let's do it. Let's say hello to Gloria.
Who are you?
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond.
James.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy. As you can see, I have no problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to buy.
So I'm here with the incomparable Gloria Hendry, a.k.a. Rosie Carver from Live and Let Die, everyone's favorite Bond girl, who's performing a jazz tribute to James Bond, to the music of James Bond, at the Barbara Morrison Performing Arts Center in Los Angeles. So thank you so much for taking some time just to talk with the James Bond Radio.
Oh, God, I'm honored. Thank you so much.
So the show was incredible, by the way. It was really a special night. I think this is just what fans really want.
Thank you so much.
Now, music's played such an important part in James Bond history. What is it about these songs in general, this body of work, that you think makes them so special?
Well, I think John Barry said it very well. He said, give it size, give it class, give it style and largeness. And that's exactly what John Barry has done. And he's wrote a pretty large bulk of the songs of the franchise. And he started it. I mean, he started from the beginning and he set the trend. So, and the songs are just wonderful. I don't understand how it is that they get that mixture of that energy that's in the song. You cannot sing these songs without energy. You can't play it without energy.
Are there some in particular that you perform tonight that are particularly exciting to perform in front of a live audience?
They all are. I hate to say, each one of them have a story, they have a backstory to it, and each one of them have a... No, I love them all.
Now, you mentioned Shirley Bassey when you were up there,
yes.
And when you performed the first song of the night, Goldfinger.
Oh, yes.
She's considered by most fans like the queen of the Bond song.
What is it
about her voice, do you think, or her style that really makes her so special to the series?
Well, she set the vocal trend, didn't she? She did Goldfinger, the third. The Bond series, the Bond franchise always looks for the artists, the well-known artists to do their material. And Shirley Bassey has class, she has style, she has, oh God, largeness. I mean, she's all exactly what they are looking for. There's nobody like Shirley Bassey. Nobody.
Well, there's nobody like you as well, especially in Live and Let Die, which is my favorite Bond film. And Roger Moore is really my favorite Bond actor. He's maybe my favorite movie star. What was he like to work with on that film?
A charmer. He was funny. He was just so great. Every time he signed an autograph, he gave it to me, too. It was like, oh, okay. And my first time out of the box to even sign an autograph. He's such a gentleman, and he shared his limousine with me every day. God, we swam in the same pool in the opposite directions every morning. He's a wonderful person, and I still know him today. We still converse back and forth through emails, through people, etc. Yeah.
Now, another legend from that film is Guy Hamilton. He's such an important figure in the James Bond world. What was your impression of him as a director?
Oh, he was wonderful. A guy would bring me aside and say, madam, call me madam. I mean, I was a young girl. Call me madam. And would just softly say some things to me, like maybe, you know, off the cuff. And then I go back into the scene, and he said, good. He knew how to pull it out of you or make you relax or give you something mentally to think about, and then when you went and did the scene, he was wonderful, great director.
Now I don't want to hold you up. You have some fans here who really want to talk to you and family members. It's so everybody always speculates on who's going to sing the next Bond song in the next film.
It's me.
Oh, so you're throwing your hat in the ring.
I'm throwing my hat in the ring.
Well, if you could pick any recording artist, because you're such a musical person, so any recording artist, past or present, to do the next Bond song, who would that be?
Golly, you know, there's such a large pool out there of males and females. I mean, that I really admire it. And also past tense, some that are not here. So I can't really give you one. I can't really just give you one. There's so many. I mean, I can see Frida Payne, you know, doing it. Mm-hmm. Besides me, but I can see Frida Payne doing it. I can see Mary Wilson. I can see Rita Coolidge. I mean, golly, there's so many.
Well, thank you so much for taking a few minutes to talk after your show. I really enjoyed it.
So how cool is that? Big thanks to Matthew Chernov for jumping in there and grabbing Gloria for us. And how lovely was Gloria?
She was, it's so nice to hear from her. And how she was just full of praise for everyone else, wasn't she? Like Sir Rogers,
yeah.
You mentioned Guy Hamilton, everyone like that. It was a lovely little interview, actually. So, thanks to Matthew for getting that. And she just seemed so friendly. And, you know, she would have happily have chatted all day, I think.
Absolutely. So Matt wrote a full review of her show. Basically, she was doing like a concert of Bond music that Matt went along to see. And he's written a blog post all about it. So if you head on over to jamesbondradio.com, you'll see his full report over there now. So you can read about the whole evening and all that kind of stuff. So that's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. So it's one of those things where you know you can't get to everything, but if you can hear about it, get an interview, read about it, see some pictures, then you know it kind of makes up for it in a way.
For sure. So it's time, Chris. It's time to turn it over to the people, right? I'm a little bit nervous because you know the sort of people that listen to this show. You never quite know what you're gonna get. Do you know what I mean? It could be very, very questionable. So let's take it easy. Let's ease ourselves in to the very first question in the MI6 mailbag. So should we do it?
Okay. Yeah, I'm looking forward to this. It's been so long. I am looking forward to it. Okay, let's hear the first question. What have we got?
Hi guys, Adam from West Yorkshire here with a question for the mailbag. With the Bond series somewhat wiping the slate clean with Casino Royale, if Eon, now I'm not too keen on the idea myself, but were to resurrect or reboot a villain from the previous films, who would you like to see return? Who would play them? And how would they fit in a new world context? Love the podcast. Keep up the great work. Thanks.
So there we are, a question from Adam from West Yorkshire. Great question. So what do we think then? If we could resurrect any villain. Now, normally, I'm completely against that. So I don't want to see Dr. No. I don't want to see a Goldfinger. I don't want to see a Emilio Largo. But because they've done it with Blofeld, that kind of, mixes it up a bit. But then the Blofeld one has been done lots before, hasn't it? And he's not kind of resurrected because he's never died. It's different, I think.
It is very different. I think the thing with Blofeld is he was unfinished business, major unfinished business as well. And there's also the thing that he was played by different actors very often. So it's like there's not like the shock of seeing somebody come along and try and being an updated Goldfinger, because it would be like, no, Goldfinger is Gert Frobe. Stay away. Don't touch it. Whereas Blofeld's a little bit different because he was played so many different times by so many different people. So yes, I think that's easy with Blofeld. Yeah. And I would say bring that on. Let's have more Blofeld all the time. If you were going to bring somebody back, I think it's probably inevitable at some point. I don't think it'll happen anytime soon, but I think it's inevitable at some point that they will remake a classic Bond film or some of the classic Bond films.
I think so.
It's probably going to happen because, like we were saying before, if you look at the climate of movies these days, there's very few original ideas coming out, and it's so many remakes and sequels and all that kind of stuff.
But then Bond has to be at the forefront of everything. Bond should be original.
I'm not saying I want it, but I feel like it's probably going to happen at some point, whether it's 30 years from now or something like that. Yeah. But I feel it's probably going to happen at some point. If they were, I tell you who I'd want to bring back, and I know exactly the person who would do one of these people anyway. I'd want to see Winton Kidd come back. That's
really?
Who I want to see come back. And the obvious choice for Mr. Wint would obviously be Crispin Glover.
Crispin, yes, so, yes. Yeah. Crispin Glover. Well, do you know what? I just like to see him as a henchman. I don't think I'd like to see him as a Mr. Wint reincarnate, because then it would just be so much comparison. And I know he'd do a bang up job, but
you could have it as like they did with Quarrel and have Mr. Wint Jr. though. Obviously, Mr. Wint's kind of, persuasions, so to speak, would make that a little bit tricky. But I feel like there's a way you could wangle that. I don't know.
Maybe.
Who would play Mr. Kidd? I don't know, but I feel like he'd be a shoo-in for Mr. Wint.
Okay, yeah. Okay, that's interesting. I had two characters in mind I would potentially reintroduce. The thing with Blofeld was, even though he did die, sort of, so to speak, in For Your Eyes Only, him coming back still didn't seem that wrong, did it?
No, it felt right. In comparison. Absolutely.
No. But the two characters who I would consider bringing back, one of them is potentially Irma Bunt.
Oh yeah, bring that on. Well, she was in one of the early drafts of Spectre, wasn't she? She was in there, so
exactly.
That's a potential.
That's it.
I feel like that's a potential for Shatterhand. Maybe that's going to be the first little hint that comes out over the next year, Chris, and it'll be like they're casting Irma Bunt. Imagine that.
That would be amazing. Now, I've got, in terms of who you'd cast as Irma Bunt, this name has been bandied about, and I think I'm 100% behind this idea, Tilda Swinton.
I'll give you that. I think she's a different, because Irma Bunt was like a butch woman, like a matronly. Yeah. I can imagine her being like a nasty old nun that would be whipping everybody with wooden rulers, like that sort of woman. Tilda's different, but I feel like as a modern reimagining of Irma Bunt, she'd be pretty top notch, I think.
Yeah, she's a great actress, and I think she can do the really warped side of things, and she could be evil, really evil. So she was one name that came to mind. Another one, if you're going for the older kind of older type woman, is Imelda Staunton. Now, she's done loads of things, like Harry Potter, a million other things. She's definitely a little bit older. So in terms of the age sort of scenario with Blofeld, the Tilda Swinton type character would definitely be better, but Imelda Staunton has got almost a Cleb like look to her. If you put Imelda Staunton evil or something like that,
God, do you know what? I couldn't picture her in my mind. It's obviously a name that I knew, but I couldn't picture her face. Yeah. So I've just googled her on my phone and look at this picture.
Think?
This screams Irma Bunt to me. Look at that.
Let's have a look. Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Not ground eyes.
Yeah. She is a bit smaller in stature, so she's not like the big butch version. But in terms of the look and the older version, I think she'd be good. But Tilda Swinton would be my number one choice. So that's one character that I actually wouldn't mind seeing coming back. The only other one is kind of a bit of a sneaky, cheaty one. But I would really like to see Hinks come back if he is supposedly dead.
Yeah, I suppose that is something that... It depends how fantastical you're going to play Bond 25, because after that injury, he could come back with like a metal arm or something. I feel like that's not going to happen. No. But like, yeah. It's to make him, like, I feel like if you're going to bring Hinks back, you need to sort of like change him a little bit, like up the game on Hinks a little bit. And I feel like, I don't know, I feel like there's some sort of, you know, do you remember maybe, how Jaws had like a metal jaw in James Bond Jr.? Yeah. I feel like that.
Well, you know, he's obviously been whipped off the train and what have you. And maybe, and the rope was around the neck. Maybe like his neck has been like implanted with metal. So because it was weak and now it's super strong. So he can't actually move his neck. So he has to move his whole upper body when he moves, but it's made his neck extra strong. So like, it just adds an extra bit of thing to him. Maybe something like that. I don't know.
I like that. They really need to hire us to take over from Purvis and Wade, don't they, Chris? With ideas like that, man, it's gonna have to happen eventually. Me with the metal jaw from James Bond Radio, you with your metal neck, taking it to the next level, right there.
That's it. But they were the only two characters that I'd really consider. I don't think I'd consider any of the old classics sort of coming back at all. But great question, though, Adam. Great question.
Absolutely. Good stuff. So next up then we have a question from Mr. Chris Hatton. So let's see what he has for us.
Hi, Tom. Hi, Chris. Chris Hatton here. I just wanted to pose you a quick question. What is your favourite poster in the series? Personally, I love the Living Daylights one with the gun barrel and the montage of the different scenes of the film around him. And it's the last of the classic painted poster designs. I think it's a brilliant poster. So what would be your favourite and least favourite, maybe? Cheers. See you in a bit.
So then, that's a good question. And I do have some very definitive feelings on that, actually. I tell you what I do like is I like the old school painted posters. And my particular favourite from those is Live and Let Die. I love that poster. I think it's brilliant.
Yeah.
What do you think?
That is a good one. That is a really good one. I love the you can just see it, the cards, the crocodiles, and Baron Samedi's on one of the cards, isn't he, or something like that. Mm. That and the speedboats. Yeah, that one really comes to mind. I remember in terms of a young kid, the For Your Eyes Only one with the legs was striking because it's the way it framed, it is pretty striking. I remember the Bond Mayday back-to-back one quite memorably in terms of just in terms of a visual appearance. But the ones I used to like were the sort of action-packed ones. I remember You Only Live Twice had some pretty cool ones with Little Nelly and loads of stuff going on. Thunderball had some cracking ones. The Living Daylights, similarly, is a good one. I remember also with the Thunderball one, with a lot of the films, sometimes they do an action pack and sometimes they do sort of the girls' ones. Obviously, they had the different patents with McGuinness and everything. Yeah. And the Thunderball one where he's wearing that orange sort of wetsuit top with the three or four Bond girls around him and with the holding the harpoons, that one just used to stick in my memory a lot. I don't know why, but I think that's a really good poster.
Do you know what? With those old sort of old school painted artworks, I think the last great Bond poster was The Living Daylights.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. That one's an absolute classic. Then after that, they did take a bit of a change. Obviously, the License to Kill one I remember because he was dressed really sort of casually, wasn't he? And it was quite dark and it was all black and there's a tanker and then the two girls and stuff like that, which is still an interesting one. I think some of the teaser posters have been great. You know, the one with just the flame of the girl in Goldeneye was a really good one. But in terms of the main posters... You know, Chris asked about sort of posters we didn't like. And now, not that I don't like them, but I think a lot of the recent ones have been quite bland. And I've seen fan-made Bond film posters, which have been outstanding, which have been so good. Like, there's a lot of the sort of skull motif and the cracked glass and everything like that with the Spectre and Skyfall. There are some great ones. And I just seeing the picture of Bond, and it's okay, but it doesn't get me going as much, really. So I would like to see Bond 25 having some proper action-y posters, I think.
Do you know what? I feel exactly the same. Like, I feel the weakest posters in the whole series have been Daniel's posters. With that said, one of his posters, the teaser poster for Casino Royale, where he's sitting at the table and he's got the gun on the table and he's just kind of like holding it, that poster just arouses me on every level. I love that poster. But yeah, all the other ones, I thought the teaser poster for Quantum, where you see his shadow, like over him holding the big gun, was kind of cool as a tension building poster. But then again, the actual, like, I don't know, I feel like a lot of Daniel's posters look like a menswear ad. Do you know what I mean? For a fragrance or something. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. They just don't have that excitement.
Yeah.
And I was so underwhelmed by the Spectre posters. I was just like, it just, let's take a photo of Daniel and stick him on a background. And it was like, ah, it was, it was a shame, man. I really felt that was, especially with all the visual imagery of the Day of the Dead stuff, man. Yeah. They could have done so much. Yeah,
exactly what I was about to say. With a big skull skeleton behind him and all this stuff going on. Yeah, I mean, that would have been, and you could have had like a part where you just see Blofeld in shadow with a long table. You could have had loads of cool stuff, couldn't you?
Yeah,
so it is a shame, but hopefully Bond 25, we might see a bit more sort of excitement and action going on in the poster world.
I don't think we will. But I think we'll probably get more of the same. But I hope, because the Spectre's posters were so bare bones, hopefully we'll get something extra. Because I tell you, when you look at like the poster for The Force Awakens and stuff, that was like a proper old school Star Wars poster. And you see the posters for like Stranger Things and stuff. And I know they're retro things, but like, I really miss those days, man. And like the Living Daylights poster, I think, is the last truly great Bond poster that we had that wasn't like photo based. Do you know what I mean? It was a piece of art rather than like, here's a picture of Pierce holding his gun. Do you know what I mean? And I do like some of the Pierce era ones. And like you say, that with the flame one of Goldeneye, where it makes out the shape of the woman, I thought was a stroke of genius.
That's cool.
But yeah, so for me, favorite poster is Live and Let Die. I do love that Casino Royale teaser poster with them at the table. My least favorite, I would say, is probably one of the Daniels. Maybe sort of. Yeah, I'd say maybe Quantum, Skyfall, or Spectre, one of those three. How about you? What to round up?
Yeah, pretty much similar thing. I think probably the Spectre Daniel one, just because, not because I didn't like it, I just found it too underwhelming compared to what they could have done with it. But yeah, I mean, in terms of favourite poster, loads of classic. I like the Thunderball look up, look down, look out. That's a classic one with all the different sort of segments. That's good. But I mean, there's probably too many to list as a favourite. But yeah, in terms of what I like, it's just a bit more than what we've seen as of late. So
good stuff.
Fingers crossed.
All right. Good question, Chris. Next up, we have a question from a Christian Evangelista, who sounds basic, like a Bond character a little bit, doesn't he? Like Agent Evangelista Bond would contact him over somewhere in South America, maybe. I think he's got something going on there. So let's have a listen to what he has to say.
Let's do it.
Hey Tom and Chris, this is Christian Evangelista. I've been a listener for a little over a year now, and I love the show. It's always a treat when it pops up in my podcast app. I live in Washington, D.C., which is home to the International Spy Museum. Since before Skyfall came out, they've had an exhibit called Exquisitely Evil, 50 Years of James Bond Villains. They've got tons of cool props, including Jaws' teeth and Blofeld's Spectre ring. So if you're ever in the neighborhood, please let me know, and I'll give you a tour. I'm friends with a few people who work there. Anyways, I want to get your opinion on two things. First, have you read the James Bond comics being put out by Dynamite? I quite enjoy them and wanted to know what you thought. Second, Adam West has famously said he turned down the role of James Bond because he thought Bond should be British. Rightfully so, but do you think he would have made a good Bond? Anyway, continue keeping the British end up. I can't wait for the next episode, and until then, this is your man in Washington, signing off.
So, Dynamite Comics, you and I, as we mentioned earlier, still haven't really got stuck into those. You know, I'm one of those that has about a million books in my queue, and I find it hard enough just to kind of like get through those. But it's definitely something we should investigate for sure. Now, moving on very, very swiftly, Adam West, let's talk about that, Chris. Do you think he'd have made, if you're going to cast an American as Bond, is Adam West the perfect man for the job or not?
Well, I tell you what you have to do. You have to get rid of every image of 60s Batman that you can, which is extremely hard to do, as that's pretty much what he's known for. But obviously, that is not how he would play it, unless it obviously went 67 Casino Royale style, like completely camp craziness, which obviously isn't what Bond is about. But
do you think he'd be like there with his Bond girl? And he'd be like, to the DB5. And then he'd run to the car, do you think? Or not?
That would be amazing. And his cue gadgets would always be in like a utility belt.
Yeah.
He'd get out his retriever from the utility belt. No, I think, in all honesty, I think he had a decent look. He definitely had a decent look for it. I think he could have played the charm side of things. Again, I just don't think it would have worked as Bond. But I think if there'd been an American secret agent of a similar type, I think he would have done great in that. I think so. But yeah, I think as Bond, as a British Bond as we know, I don't think it would have worked probably.
Absolutely.
But I still think he would have still made a semi-decent job.
Speaking of Americans playing Bond, I think there are two gentlemen who I would say, okay, let's do it. I feel like, no disrespect to our American cousins, I think you see a lot of English actors playing American, don't you? Like your Spider-Mans, your Supermans and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And I feel like that kind of works. I don't, apart from Bridget Jones, I haven't seen many American actors really pull off playing somebody British. And somebody, I might be wrong, there's a lot of our American listeners are probably screaming at me right now, but there are two dudes who I think could do the job. John Hamm being one of them, obviously Mad Men. He's got a real classic old school look to him, obviously, and I think he'd do a bang up job. And the other one, I can't quite say his name, is Jim Caviezel. He played Jesus in that Mel Gibson movie. Yeah, he's got a strong look about him. I feel like those two could be contenders. Whether they could pull off the subtle nuances that being a British man kind of entails, I don't know. But I don't know. What do you think?
Those two are good shouts in terms of, I mean, in all honesty, I think, I prefer someone. Again, if they pull off a British accent, does it matter where they're from?
What about the dude from Ocean's 11? Do you remember he was an American and put on a British accent? Do you remember him?
Brad Pitt, was it?
No,
oh, John Cheadle. Don Cheadle. that was the worst accent I've ever heard. Yeah, they put a pony on it. It's like, yeah, that was great. Yeah, maybe we should get Don Cheadle. I think he'd be good.
There you go. Everybody will be happy. There won't be any controversy there at all. But Don Cheadle for Bond number 7, that's for sure. Good stuff. So thank you for that question, Christian. Next up, it's Dazzy Nobbs. He's back. He's got a question for us. Let's see what he's got to say.
Hi, Chris and Tom. This is Darren Noble calling in from Southampton, UK, with a topic for the MI6 mailbag about the legends of Bond. The recent sad passing of Ken Adam made me reflect on the significant contribution he made to the Bond film legacy. And this got me thinking about which other members of the creative team would make it onto a top 10 list of all-time Bond legends. Who would you choose? If you're interested, my choices would be in no particular order. 1, Cubby Broccoli. 2, Harry Saltzman. 3, Barbara Broccoli. 4, Michael Wilson. 5, Maurice Binder. 6, John Barry. 7, Ken Adam. 8, Richard Maybaum. 9, Terence Young. And 10, Peter Lamont. Keep doing what you're doing, guys. Over and out.
Okay, so there we are. Great question, Darren. Thanks for that. Now, interesting, isn't it? Straight off, if he kind of listed everyone that came to mind, straight away. So I think, in terms of people outside of that 10 that Darren chose, I was just trying to think. I think Bob Simmons could potentially be a shout. Obviously, he was the main stuntman back then, set up all the choreography, the stunt fights, everything like that. And so he had a big input. But I don't think it was quite as big as the other names that were mentioned by Darren there. I don't know. What do you think? It was.
I think outside of the core family members of like Cubby, Saltzman, Barbara, Michael G and all those kinds of people, I feel like to be a top 10 legend, let's look at the list that Darren provided for us. So outside of those four, obviously, you got Maurice Binder. Like, again, he created some truly iconic stuff with the gun barrel and those title sequences and all that kind of stuff. So that's a no-brainer. John Barry basically created the sound of Bond. So that's a no-brainer. Ken Adam, visually with those sets, like unbeatable as far as I'm concerned with that kind of stuff, alongside Peter Lamont, obviously. So there's two. Richard Mayborn, I mean, yeah, of course, like that's the man that kind of started it all really in terms of the, you know, the screenplays and all that kind of stuff. Terrence Young is the man who invented the screen Bond at the very start. You know, if his vision of what Bond would be on the screen wasn't there, would we even have Bond at all? So it's, I feel like the 10 Darren gave us are the 10, basically. Yeah. I would say, moving
if you
away,
were to choose 10, if you were to choose 10, but not including the producers, and we've got 6 so far, who would you think would fill the other 4 shoes?
I'm gonna throw some stuff out there. Now, purists, old school purists, might balk at some of these comments I'm about to make, but I feel like, you know, time has passed since then. We're in a new era of Bond right now. So I would say contenders, right?
Yeah.
David Arnold, quite possibly. I feel like he provides the sound of the modern day Bond and has done for a long time now. So hopefully, because we now have Sam Mendes back, we're going to see him return for Bond 25. That's my big hope. Come on, David, come back, please. I would say he's a contender, especially if he does come back and do more. How about this? I'm just going to throw this out there because we had old Dickie Mayborn mentioned there. What about Purvis and Wade?
Maybe.
Now, they are responsible for the most financially successful Bond film of all time in Skyfall. They've guided the modern day Bond through a lot of stuff and have had some massive successes. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely a worthy shout, I think. Well, the amount of films they've worked on, I mean, Casino, obviously, is what a film, you know. They've worked on a lot of films. And yeah, I think that's it. That's potentially a good show. You've also got Daniel Kleiman, who took over from Maurice, who's done all the loads of, obviously he didn't do Quantum, did he? But he's done a load of the title sequence. But what about Guy Hamilton? He introduced a whole, that Bond Q scene in Goldfinger, if it wasn't for Guy Hamilton, Bond could have been straight-laced the whole way through. He helped to bring the humour and create that side of Bond. So I think Guy Hamilton definitely deserves to be in that top 10 as well.
I feel like, yes, and I feel like you could make the argument about Lewis Gilbert as well, like with that, you've got the you're on
Peter
your
Hunt,
which
the,
was,
the editor, Peter Hunt
I mean,
as
yeah,
well.
There's another one. And I feel like the danger is with discussing something like this is you can get caught, like the difference is you've got, when you look at the modern day crop of people, like your Purvis and Wades and your David Arnolds, but then when you go back, you've got the dudes who actually invented these things. Do you know what I mean? It's like, how could you possibly conceive of the idea of the gun barrel opening up every movie? That's like, I don't even know how you come up with that. Obviously, there's that line we spotted in the Dr. No book, obviously, which when he's in the tunnels, he says, as he's crawling through it, looked like looking down a long gun barrel. So I assume that's what the, you know, inspiration for that was. But then you could say, okay, David Arnold is, he does his own thing, but he's very heavily influenced by John Barry and all that kind of stuff. So I feel like you could just rattle off all those old school dudes. Peter Hunt is a perfect example. You know, and then you've got people like John Glenn, who fostered Bond throughout the whole 80s and all that kind of stuff. So it's tough to whittle it down to just 10. I think really you have to take the core family members out, because Cubby, Barbara, Michael G, you know, Harry Saltzman and all that kind of stuff goes without saying. So I think without those, you could possibly add in, who do we say? Guy Hamilton, we added in.
Definitely.
Peter Hunt added in.
Yeah.
I'd say stick into the classic crop. I would say perhaps Lewis Gilbert. And at the end of the day, You Only Live Twice and Spy Love Me, they're pretty banging, earth-shattering movies, aren't they? And quite possibly John Glenn as well.
Yeah, I'd say, well, yeah. I mean, I know he was back in the 80s. He wasn't back at the start, but I mean, he still put his own stamp. I mean, directors obviously have a huge influence, don't they? They put their own stamp on it and stuff. Yeah. But like you said, you could just list hundreds and hundreds of people. But great question. It's good to get the debate going, isn't it? For sure.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
Honourable mention, obviously, for Lee Tamahori, just at the end there.
To Lee Tamahori, he'd probably be number one, I'd imagine, out of our choices. But there we go. Okay, so our next question we have is from Mr. Edgar Shippey. Should we have a little listen to Edgar's question?
Let's do it.
Hello, James Bond Radio, Tom, Chris, the lovely listeners, of course. This is Edgar Chaput, in Montreal, Station C, Canada. I'm sending in this voicemail for the listener mailbag episode. You can use it whenever you want, whether it's the next one or the one after. I must confess, I'm recording this the day after having listened to the Sir Roger Moore interview. What an episode, guys. What an interview. Such class. He's such a cool guy. I'm absolutely delighted that you guys did that interview. And thank you for it, by the way. Good work. Great work. So essentially, a very simple question for you guys. You know, we often talk about who's our favorite Bond, what's our favorite Bond girl, Bond movie. What would tickle my fancy would be to know, what's your favorite QC? I mean, I love Desmond Llewellyn. I'm sure you guys love Desmond Llewellyn. Everybody loves Desmond Llewellyn. We're slowly falling in love with Ben Whishaw right now with the Through Two films. So what is your favorite Q scene? For me, it's the one in GoldenEye. I find that's the one where, interestingly, Desmond Llewellyn seems to be having the most fun. He seems to have more of an amicable relationship with 007. And I love the line, "Don't touch that. That's my lunch." So there you go, guys. That's my favorite. What's your favorite? And keep up the great work. Legendary interview with Sir Roger. Love the show. See you next time.
So this is a great question, and I feel like we should do probably a two-parter episode on the Q scenes of Bond at some point. I think that's a given.
That has got to happen. That has to happen, definitely.
I'm going to let you start, because I've got several in mind, but what do you have a particular one that jumps into your mind?
Yes, I do. So we're talking about favourite film with Q or favourite scene, because that's a bit different, because if you look at License to Kill, he's in it loads, and that's great. Mm-hmm. But there are two films that come to mind. One of them only has pretty much one scene with Q. The other one has four. Now, the one that initially came to mind straight away was Thunderball. It's the first time we see Q in the field. The chemistry between Connery and Desmond in that scene is just unreal. It's pitch perfect. It's so good. You can see how frustrated he is. He's got his big pineapple shirt on. Bond is just like, is that clever? If you can take pictures with me in the film in the morning,
I love it. I love when Q first walks in and Bond clocks him and goes, "Oh no!" And then as he runs, I love that bit where he's like, "Is that clever?" Yeah. And it so illustrates the relationship, because it's like Bond does not give a shit about these gadgets, and Q loves those gadgets, and I just love that moment. Is that clever? And then Q gets on his high horse. Love it.
And he keeps on turning on he turns on the fans as near the underwater propulsion unit, and he's just playing around and with the homing pill, swallow it now and all that sort of stuff. I think that for me is probably, if I had to pick one single scene, obviously Goldfinger's a classic because you've got the Aston Martin, but I think for one single scene, I think my favourite would be Thunderball. I think I love that scene. But another film, which perhaps doesn't get as much mention in terms of the Q scenes, which I think is equally as good, is The Spy Who Loved Me, because we get to see Q so many times. So we get to see him when they're talking about, the missile bomber tail fire, when he's obviously talking about the tracking system. We get to see him deliver the Lotus. We get to see him in the Pyramid Base HQ in Cairo. And we get to see him at the end when they rock up on the ship and stuff like that. So we get, and like the scenes in the pyramid bit is cool, with all of his workshop. The scenes where he delivers the Lotus, it's brief, but it's really cool. So I think, obviously, License to Kill, brilliant because of the amount, but I think Spy is probably the second best in terms of the amount of Q scenes that you get. So that's my thought on it. What about you?
So I'm in total agreement about Thunderball. That's the one that raises the biggest smile for me, is that Thunderball Q scene. Love it. However, there are some other ones that do leap to mind as well. One of my favourite Q moments, as ridiculous as it is, one of my favourite Q moments is in Octopussy, when he goes into the confession chamber and it's like, you don't even see Q. And it's like, "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned." And then that's putting it mildly, 007. That is the best intro to a Q scene I have ever seen in all my life. I love that line. That's beautiful.
In Few Eyes Only, that one. Yeah.
Few Eyes Only. Sorry, not Octopussy. I'm an idiot. Yeah, Few Eyes Only.
But that line is so good, isn't it? It's delivered so well.
Bloody love it. So there's that one. And I tell you what I do like as well. I really like the Tomorrow Never Dies Q scene. Now, I was talking with good old Steve Thorpe, JBR listener extraordinaire, on Facebook about this. Old Ralph got involved as well. That scene where he goes to pick up his rental car, and obviously Q's in character as well as like the rental car man and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And there's and that his red Avis jacket and all that.
Yeah, and it's like, it's that same little like old school Connery interplay between them. I love the bit where like he's like, Will you need collision coverage for your... He's like, here's the waiver for your beautiful new car. Will you need collision coverage? He's like, yes. And that just like all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I just love how like great. that little subtle smirk Pierce has on his face the whole time through that scene. Yeah. I love that moment. Yeah. That's really good. Really good. So that one from more recent times, that's one that stands out for me as well.
That is a good one. That's really good. Yeah. And obviously GoldenEye, which is a great one as well. Obviously don't touch that. It's my lunch. That's a classic, isn't it?
Yeah.
But Tomorrow Never Dies is good. I've got a trivia question for you. Oh. Do you know the name badge that Q is wearing in that scene in Tomorrow Never Dies?
It's got
a first name and a second name.
It's, no, I don't.
It, so you know how with M, we know Miles, Mesa V, supposedly, and like Mallory and Barbara Maudsley is one potential one for Judy Dench. Now, this one is... Quentin Quigley.
Nice. I like it.
Yes.
That's a good name.
Yeah. So I thought that was quite cool. So I reckon, so overall, the good ones we've got, I'd say, would be Thunderball, Spy, Tomorrow Never Dies. I mean, there are lots on there. GoldenEye. But yeah, so Thunderball for me and Tomorrow Never Dies for you, I reckon.
Thunderball is definitely my favorite, right? I'd say those two are like close runner-ups, I think, For Your Eyes Only for me and Tomorrow Never Dies. But
I'm looking forward to doing the episodes.
It's going to happen, man. It has to happen. That is going to be a good one. It's always some of the most fondest scenes, I think, in the history of Bond. So that's going to be good. So thank you for that, Mr. Chapu. Next up, we have Mr. Jeff Silence.
Hey guys, Jeff Silence here. I kind of had a little theoretical question I wanted to run by you guys. It kind of came out of a night of drinking with some friends. It's, good debates tend to do. It made for a pretty long and odd conversation. So let's imagine all the Bonds are in a Ben-Hur style of race. Each Bond gets his own iconic car. So Sean would get the DB5. Roger gets the Lotus Esprit. Timmy gets the V8 Vantage. Pierce gets his cell phone controlled BMW, and Danny gets his DB10 from Spectre. George kind of got left out of the conversation because he didn't really have a gadget-laden car, and the big car chase scene was more Tracy driving. But for fairness sake, let's just add him in. So, who do you think would win the race? Remember, it's Ben-Hur style, so you can use superior driving skills, gadgets, every other dirty trick you could think of. So it'll be interesting to hear what you guys come up with.
Okay, great question again, Jeff Silence there. So, in fact, this is one that I've never thought of before. Normally, you kind of think of almost every eventuality that you can in Bond. Okay, so we've got each of the James Bond actors in one of their James Bond cars having almost like a wacky races face-off where they can use gadgets. Like you mentioned, obviously, Ben-Hur trying to fight each other. So you've got Connery in the DB5. George will just stick him in the DBS, even though, just so he's around. Roger Moore, obviously, in his Sir Roger in his Lotus. We've got Timmy Boy in his V8 Vantage. We've got Pierce. Now, Pierce could have had any number of cars. He could have had the Z3, wouldn't have done so well. The Z8, even the Vanquish. Obviously, he had a lot of capabilities. But we're going to go with the 750 from Tomorrow Never Dies, and then obviously Danny Boy in his DB10. So, what do we think? It's interesting, isn't it?
Yes. So, here are my thoughts, right? So I think what we have to do is look at the Bond themselves and how they handle themselves behind the wheel, and obviously the weapon of choice, which is obviously their car. Now, start with Connery.
Yep.
Aside from the Vegas car chase, I don't think we really get to see Connery, certainly not in the DB5, have any kind of iconic kind of chase or a chase where he uses all his stuff. All the DB5 stuff happens in quite a casual environment when he's, there's Tilly Masterson and he rams off the road and stuff. And we see a little bit of it, but we don't really see it in all its glory, I don't think.
That's interesting.
So there's that. Let's just put that to one side for a minute. George, we never really see do anything cool behind the wheel of the car. We see him tailing, obviously, Tracy at the very beginning. And then, the big car chase in that, Tracy's behind the wheel. So I feel like George is at probably the bottom of the pile there in terms of because we never see him behind the wheel, and he certainly doesn't have a car that's loaded with gadgets.
That's true.
So I feel like he'd be the first casualty. As much as I love him, Sheila, please don't be upset, but I feel like that would be the case. Are you in agreement there, or do you have any other thoughts?
He can make sand squeal, like the tyres squeal over sound. That's quite impressive.
That is quite a talent, yeah, yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
But yeah, like you said, when Tracy's obviously behind the wheel during the stock car race. And similarly with Sean, we do see him in Dr. No having that little sort of chase with the hearse, and he outruns a hearse. I know it's not a big chase, but he does something there. Obviously, mm-hmm. the Diamonds Are Forever car chase is quite cool. But then in Tomorrow Never Dies, he's driven around by Aki, isn't he? And mm-hmm. in Thunderbolt.
In You Only Live Twice, you mean?
It's in You Only Live Twice, yeah. And in Thunderbolt, he's driven around by Fiona, although not in a race, but, you know. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think Diamonds is his best display of car drivership.
Now, I have three Bonds in mind who I think are reasonably even matched. I'm going to reel them off to you.
Go for it.
Sir Roger Moore in The Spy Who Loved Me. I think there's some excellent driving that happens there. We see him dispatch a helicopter. We see him drive underwater, for crying out loud. Yeah. So I think that's a definite contender.
Yeah.
Contender number two, I would say, is the Timmy D.
Yeah.
Living Daylights, we get to see that used to full effect with the afterburner motor. We get to see him cut a hole in the ice, laser the car next to him and all that kind of stuff. I feel like that's a classic car scene with gadgets. I think Timmy's up there. I think certainly one of the most memorable scenes for me from that era is the car park car chase in Tomorrow Never Dies being remote controlled. We certainly see the car put through the run of the mill there. Not that's the wrong expression. Put through the mill. That's what they say, isn't it? Yeah. With those little missiles and the little spiky balls that drop down and the fact that he's controlling it with his phone. I think those are the three big contenders for this battle. Honorable mention for Danny Boy, obviously. So like you have the Spectre car. But again, I suppose you have the flamethrower, you have the parachute.
What about his driving?
I feel
what
like
about his driving skill in Quantum? He's one of the best drivers. I would probably put him as the best driver along with Roger Moore in Quantum. His car, that car chase in Quantum, he rocks, man.
That is a fair point. That is a fair point. I'd neglected to think about that. Yeah. In a battle, so basically we don't see any gadgets with that one, but you do see him machine gunning cars. That is a brilliant chase, man. I love that chase. Yeah. That's very frantic and stuff.
It's hard to know what to talk about. So if we're talking about driver skill and gadgets, then we've got to take every time we see them behind a wheel into account to see how good they are.
Yeah.
But then obviously transfer that skill to them in their gadget car. So taking Danny Boy from Quantum, you can transfer that skill to him in the DB10. So he's got that skill. Obviously, he does the car chase inspector as well. Plus, he's got those gadgets.
Mm.
Although I would say that DB10 is slightly limited in hardware compared to the DB5 or the Lotus, for instance, is fully loaded. It's fully stocked, isn't it? Fully loaded.
Yeah, absolutely.
The Lotus. Yeah. So, okay then. So what sort of idea are you getting in terms of who sort of jumps to mind then in terms of driver skill and the car that's been chosen?
I would say Connery doesn't come out on top. I'd say George doesn't come out on top. I'd say Daniel out of those three is probably the best out of those three behind the wheel. But I feel like his car isn't, we haven't yet seen him in a scenario where he's really put the car to the test. Do you know what I mean? With different gadgets, we see a bit of flamethrower, we see the parachute. That's great. That's fine. Yeah. But when you compare it to what happens in Daylights, what happens in Spy, what happens in Tomorrow Never Dies, I think that's the next level of car battle shenanigans. I think they are the main three contenders. What are your thoughts?
I'm just going to go out straight away and say I think Roger Moore would win in the Lotus Esprit because I think it can fire. It's got missiles that fire out front. It's got missiles that fire out the roof. It's got the cement that flies out the back. It's got ink that flies out the back. Mm. It's got the mine that drops below. It can go through water. It's super fast. He outmaneuvers a helicopter. The way he 360s around that post in the road, outmaneuvering the helicopter. And it's fast and it's light. And for me, I think it would take out any of the other cars.
And let's face it, Timmy's car is very geared up for winter sports. So if there was no mention of terrain, so you've got to assume that it would be normal terrain in this particular battle. So I feel like Timmy would be at disadvantage. So I would say it would ultimately come down to Pierce versus Roger, but I agree with you. I think Roger would come out on top.
because if you look at it, like, Timmy's car has got the forward firing missiles. He's only got two. Pierce has got forward firing missiles. Roger's got forward firing and vertical firing. And, you know, I think he's got lots. I think the BMW has lots of gadget hardware, but I don't think in terms of speed it would come up to the Aston V8 Vantage or the DBS.
And it has to be said, yeah, that BMW is quite boring to look at as well. And I think
that is a knock
against its favour as well. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think the top three would be Danny Boy in the DBS, Rog in the Lotus, and Tim in the V8. Now, a lot of people are probably thinking, what about Connery in the DB5? But the DB5, it's good for close combat, but it hasn't got any firing missiles, has it, or anything like that. So it's got the guns, but that's not enough, I don't think, compared to the other cars that we've talked about.
I feel like you see the DB5 using those gadgets in quite a laid-back thing, don't you, when it's like tailing Tilly Masterson or whatever. You never see it at real battle as such. No. You do a little bit, obviously, but, you know, it didn't end well. So I think Roger wins.
I think, Daniel would probably win in a straight race with Roger, or maybe alongside Roger, but the DB10 hasn't got as many sort of gadgets to unleash. I think the BMW has lots of gadgets, but it's a bit slow. It's not great. And I'm just not sure about that one. I think the V8 Vantage is good, but again, it's not got a lot. It's got the missiles, which are great. It's got the side lasers, which are brilliant, but that's about it. Whereas I think the Lotus just has loads. And the way that he outmaneuvers the helicopter, I think, is amazing. So I think my vote's going to go with Rog and the Lotus.
Yeah, absolutely. So Bond car battle, Roger comes out on top. Congratulations.
There we go.
Good start.
Nice one.
So next question is from longtime JBR listener, Mr. Matthew Grice. Let's see what he has to say for himself.
Hi, Tom and Chris. It's JBR listener Matthew Grice here. I'm just wondering on what are your thoughts about a James Bond TV series? Basically, I've had this idea for, probably about 15 years now to have a James Bond TV series called 00, based on the 1970s comic strips based by John McCluskey and I think Jim Lawrence, also... a lot of people have said that, you know, James Bond should be purely for the cinema. But then I've spoken to fans who also got this quite a nice idea of having a sort of TV series based on the Fleming novels, but like a true faithful adaptation of, Live and Let Die and Moonraker, which are probably the finest examples. I was just wondering what your thoughts on a James Bond TV series would be like. I'd be interested in to hear your thoughts on that. Okay, bye for now, and keep up with the good works, guys. Bye.
So do you think, first of all, was Gricey having a bath, do you think, when he called in that message?
I think he was definitely having a bath. Definitely having a bath. I had that little water droplet at the end, and I'm sure he's just there listening, coming up with, like, James thinking about Bond, thinking, I know, what question can I come up with JBR, while he's giving himself his undercarriage a bit of a clean. I think he's definitely
at least a bath. I hope it was a bath and he wasn't sat on the toilet just getting that done while he was calling in a message. But there we go.
Hopefully not.
So, good question, Mr. Grice. So, yes.
Yeah.
Original adaptations of Fleming stories for the TV. Now, interesting point. Everybody says Bond is made for the big screen, and I would agree. However, with the quality of the stuff on TV lately, I feel like that outweighs... I'm not talking about Bond here. It's just generally speaking, some of the TV shows that are out these days are literally blowing what's in the cinema out of the water. Things like Breaking Bad, Stranger Things, for example, all super top quality stuff. So I definitely think there's room for it. And I think a period... old school, set in the 50s, original, true to the books thing would be bloody great. What do you think?
I've always been behind that idea, definitely. Like a complete adaptation of Fleming novels. I think you'd need really good production value. You couldn't do it on the cheap. You'd have to do it, like, if it was a BBC, for instance, you know, just make it your big thing of that year. And I'd love to see it. I think it's great because... we're never ever gonna, otherwise how else are we gonna see it? Obviously we get snippets in the films, but the stuff that's been left behind, there's still a lot there, and I'm pretty sure that not all of it could be made into sort of part of the film franchise for particular reasons that, you know, when the books were set and stuff like that. But no, I think a directed adaptation would be amazing. In terms of like the comic books, the 70s comic book strips that Gricey mentioned, I mean, again, that could be interesting. But my sort of knowledge of that area isn't quite so good. So if I had a choice, I'd go direct Fleming adaptations. But could it happen? I really don't know if it could, just because
Eon would need
a hand in it, wouldn't they?
Yeah, as much as I would love to see it, I feel like whatever leftover Fleming stuff they have in there, they'd want to use on the big screen. And, you know, the Garden of Death, Shatterhand is a perfect example. Like, there is absolutely the foundation for Bond 25 in that story, and it's never been done on the screen before. So I feel like if that was out there as a TV series, I feel like they wouldn't be into that. I feel like they know they've got a good thing on the big screen, and they're going to keep it that way, I feel, as much as I'd love to see a TV series.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I completely agree. But you can always sort of fantasize and imagine what it was like. What about now? I think this was mentioned previously. What about an actual adult animated version of Bond? Now, I'm not talking like porn animation or anything like that. yes. But do you know what I mean? Like really sort of almost like, you know, the sort of dark, what do you call the sort of, you know, dark comic strips we're talking about.
Do you know what? I think this question might have come up in the last Mailbag episode, because I remember talking about Batman the Animated Series and how amazing that was.
Yeah.
And us talking about that. Maybe that was the last Mailbag episode, but that definitely came up. But yeah, I think that could work. But again, what you got to think is something like Star Wars is run by a huge major company like Disney, whereas Eon is still a family-run business, isn't it? So I feel like it's a much smaller operation, and I feel like it's all about...
But if it was done adaptation from the comic strip, so it wasn't directly related to the films or shown in live-action form on TV... Would that still be affected by Eon? I mean, I'm sure they'd have to still have a say in it, wouldn't they? But
yeah,
I don't know. Who knows? It's all food for thought, though, isn't it? So
indeed. So next question is from good old Steve Batchelor. So let's see what he has to say for himself.
Hello, Tom and Chris. Steve Batchelor here. Loving JBR as ever. It's not just a show, it's a way of life. So my question for you, or thought about Bond, is... what area of Bond's life would you like to know more about? I've always thought there's a brilliant series of books around Bond's wartime experiences. We get hints and tips and bits in some of the novels and references elsewhere, but obviously Bond's naval career and what he was up to during the Second World War, as it would have been in Fleming's universe, would be great for a series of books. So what are your thoughts on that? And what other areas of Bond's life would you like to know more about? Keep up the good work, guys. Cheers.
That's a good question, Steve. Absolutely. I think Bond's experiences, if you're going true to the Fleming timeline, Bond's experiences during the Second World War definitely would be of interest. That's something I'd want to hear about. Hopefully, I'm hoping that's what eventually happens with young Bond. Like when we go through the books, is we'll cover that kind of area. That would definitely be something I'd be up for. How about you?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to think in terms of narrative, in terms of timeline. So following the current crop of young Bond, what stage would Bond's life be thereafter? Because there's still the gap, I'd imagine, between Red Nemesis and entering the Navy, joining the Navy. I'm imagining there's probably a period of time there.
Yeah.
He's got his time in the Navy, during the Navy, training in the Navy. The wartime operations where you could really see he becomes a proper fine-tuned killer. Yeah. You know, he makes his first proper kills and stuff like that. And you know, it's not, I don't mean, that's not the same as a 00, that's different. I don't mean like assassination or that sort of thing. I mean, just being in that environment would be really interesting. And seeing him do some sneaky stuff, like imagine like planting like a limpet mine on a German sub or something like that. On, you know, I don't know, just stuff like that. I think
the story that needs to be told is how he gets the rank of commander. I think that's the story that we need to find how he reaches that point. So yeah, I think there's a huge amount. I don't think we'll ever see that on screen. I think that's for the world of the books, I think, ultimately. No. Whether that's a young Bond thing or whether it's one of the adult continuation authors and it's like a prequel, that's something that I definitely want to see for sure. Good stuff.
I think it's going to happen as well. It will definitely happen, won't it?
Yeah, it has to.
I think at some point. Sure. It's got to.
Yeah.
Cool. So next question then we have is from Tom Barwick. Should we have a listen and see what Tom's question is?
Hello, Chris. Hello, Tom. It's Tom Barwick here, and I thought I'd just phone in with a question for you for your next MI6 mailbag. And my question is this. Do you think that there are any of the more recent Bond films that are due to do a Majesty's? And what I mean by that is they're not necessarily that well appreciated in their time, but they get reappraised further down the line and become more appreciated, and people will like them even more. Obviously, you've spoken about this. The old thing with Majesties was that a lot of people used to say, "Well, George wasn't very good, so they replaced him and everything," which we all know not to be true now. But I just wonder whether there are any films that you think are due to be reappraised in the same way, because Majesties obviously is a firm fan favorite. For what it's worth, I think that probably there are two candidates that for this, and I would probably say License to Kill and Quantum, probably due to be some kind of reappraised. I think if you watch them now, I think you can get more from them than you would have at the time. Anyway, thanks very much. See you guys.
Okay, great question there from Tom. So any films that we think will do a Majesty's? Now, there are a couple, obviously he mentioned there, License to Kill and Quantum. In all honesty, I think License to Kill is pretty much there already, because the amount of fandom that I see for that film, rightly so in some respects, definitely. I think that's already reached that sort of path. Not in comparable levels to Majesty's, because that film is almost untouchable. But in terms of growing from once it was deemed as a critical failure up to the point where it is a great film and people appreciate that, I think it's already reached that level. Whereas Quantum, I think, hasn't. And although might be starting to creep up a little bit in people's estimations, I think that's still got a fair way to go. But what's your thoughts on that then?
Well, I think it all comes down to the times in which we live. So, for example, it's very fashionable to hate on Pierce now and all that kind of stuff, because we are currently in the Daniel era, which is obviously a lot darker and all that kind of stuff. So the fashionable thing is to be like, well, Timothy Dalton was the man, he was before his time and all that kind of stuff. And that's all absolutely valid points and all the rest of it. I feel like ultimately there has to become a point where the dark and gritty goes out of fashion and people just want to have a bit of fun again. And then say that's the next dude that comes along, for example, and it's more like the old school Bond, that, the Pierce and the Rogers and the Shawns, and it's more along those lines. In which point I would hope things would swing back in the other direction and Pierce would get the sort of appreciation that he, in my opinion, downright deserves. So I think ultimately what people will look back on in years to come is maybe one of the Pierces. I think maybe a GoldenEye is a good example. Not that that really gets slagged off. I think that's, no. I think most people are in agreement that that's a good one. I feel like maybe A World Is Not Enough. Like the thing about that film is that almost became like an all-time classic, and it was just let down by a few things, and I think maybe that one might get a bit more appreciation. I don't know, what have you got, any that sort of jump out at you
out of the Pierces? I really like Tomorrow Never Dies. I find that quite a really good watch. Light-hearted, definitely, but I find it a really good watch, and I think that one for me has lots of classic Bond elements in it. Tomorrow Never Dies. Obviously, we mentioned the car earlier, and I think Brosnan looks amazing in that film. There are some obviously silly moments in it, but I think that one could potentially be a bit of a grower, so to speak. I don't know. It's strange, isn't it? Like you said, it does depend on the times. I would like to see, I'm all about Bond being cyclical. I'm all about, you know, let's seeing what was then we see again, you know, what's now goes to pasture for some time, so to speak. So yeah, no, I definitely agree. It'll be nice to go back towards the lighter side. And obviously Spectre was hinting at that in quite a lot, which was cool. But mm-hmm. I wouldn't want the next five Bond films to be all dark, revengey and gritty, because I think I'd lose interest and that would be really sad. And I don't think it will, because Eon are clever and they know what they're doing. That's why Bond has survived for 24 films, is because it keeps reinventing itself and going through all these different sort of areas, so to speak. So yeah. I think you're right. I think we'll definitely see a lighter side. In terms of films that will pick up, I don't think we'll ever get a film that goes from being heavily, heavily criticised to being like a potential number one with fans. I think if Casino Royale had been criticised, then that could have been one. But no one criticised it because it was so good. In terms of films that people don't like, I agree. I think Quantum will be a bit more appreciated with people. Like, I obviously slated it when it first came out, but I appreciate it a lot more now. And I think that will be one. So it's interesting, but it'll be interesting to see. What about any of the we sort of said Quantum. But in terms of Skyfall and Spectre, they've both got their fans, haven't they? They've both got their fans, Skyfall and Spectre, and I wonder how they'll be looked on in like 10 years' time.
I would hope Spectre is one of those that with the people, I think that's a 50-50 splitter, isn't it? Or maybe slightly in the majority with the negative opinion. I feel like in time, people will just sort of like get over the things they don't like about it and let it be what it is. Which is fucking brilliant as far as I'm concerned. Only time will tell, I guess. But yeah, I suppose using Majesties as an example is tip trough, because that is something that sits on its own. You would never say The World Is Not Enough would do a Majesties, because they're in totally different leagues of films. No. But there we go.
I think Spectre has the potential, sure. Not to be like that, but I think that's out of the most recent ones, that's definitely the one that I think will be more appreciated than it currently is in a few good years'
call.
Time.
So, Mr. Barwick, call back in 10 years to 20 years' time, and we'll see what's happened. We'll see what the lay of the land is. Absolutely. So, in the last of our voice message questions, we have a message from good old Barney Metcalf. So, let's see what he's got to say. Mm.
Hey Chris and Tom, head of Section A, Australia, Barney Metcalf here, and I'm just having a little Sunday chillax, watching a little bit of Roger's Spy Who Loved Me, and I'm in the middle of the pre-title sequence on the British submarine, and I've never noticed this before. I had to rewind and just double check that I was definitely seeing this. The guy who like walks down the corridor with all the beds and stuff, and then goes into the cafeteria area, on the wall as he comes out there are many pictures of women lifting their bikini tops off for many a man to have a gaze at, many a nipple. So us boys always love, we always love a little bit of bomb nipplage. So there's a lot of it here, so next time watch Spy Who Loved Me, watch out for that in the pre-title sequence. Glad to be of help, gentlemen.
So Barney, we need time references, man. We need time references. If you're gonna do this properly, we need time references so we can all follow along at home and get the precise frames for maximum nippleage. What do you think about that, Chris?
Well, amateur level here, isn't it? No, we're only joking, Barney. It's a great shout, though. I mean, also, I'm hoping that he saw it on Blu-ray, HDTV, and really took the time to examine up close what that screen had to offer. I think we might have mentioned that before, did we, when we reviewed Spy?
I think you probably spotted it.
Yeah. But I mean, any nippleage is good nippleage, so we appreciate it. And doing the work as well, I love it, Barney. Excellent. Yeah. We need our sort of roving nipple spotters out there.
I'd like to nominate myself for that role. Good work, Barney. We do need to make a directory of nipple sightings, don't we, for the JBL website?
Honestly,
I feel like Barney would want to get involved. Yeah. Barney, if you you're watching them, just note it down, get some time references for us, and we'll put together a blog post, The Nipples of Bond, thanks to Barney Metcalf. We'll get it out there. It'll be great.
And we could do a little write-up, and maybe once we've got all the time references, we could edit together a montage of Bond nippleage. You know, it could be all thanks to Barney's hard work.
Good work. Nicely done. So that about rounds out the listener questions for this time around. This is the fourth MI6 mailbag that we've done. So thank you for contributing. Obviously, if your question didn't make it into the mailbag this time, we'll keep it for the next time we do it. And we should probably start doing these a little bit more often, to be honest, because they're always fun, aren't they?
We will do it more often. I think it's just been the gap for various reasons has happened, but we will do more. And I've got a big backlog of questions, so we've got enough to do another mailbag, so we can do that one maybe, you know, a lot sooner than obviously the last gap's been. But again, if you've got any other questions, feel free, send a voicemail in, and and we'll play them on the next show.
Good stuff. Sounds good. So we should probably get back to the listener trivia question of the day, shouldn't we? But from William Robertson, I believe it was.
Yes, it was. Now, his question was a good one. It was, in which Bond films have you seen a snooker or pool table? Now, I think you said you had one that came to mind. Mm. Do you remember that?
I'm not sure if this is just an assumption. I would imagine the Barrelhead Bar from License to Kill had a pool table in it.
I remember there's a fight and someone's got a cue, haven't they? So there must be. It must have been.
There must
yeah,
be.
I think
yeah.
you're 100% right. So definitely License to Kill is one. Can we think of any others?
I can't think of any, to be honest, apart from that.
Oh, yeah. No, you got to be. Classic one.
Go on.
And it's a trick one. Say those words. Trick.
Hold on. What's with that trick pool table? Yes. Goldfinger. There it is. Good work, man.
Yes. Yeah. Good one. What else we got? There's got to be a couple more.
I feel like maybe the Filet of Soul in Live and Let Die, there's probably a pool table in there.
Yes.
Yeah.
There definitely is, because I remember when he walks in and you hear, and I remember, Filet of Soul. Definitely Filet of Soul, there's one. So that's three. And I've thought of one other. And it's related to... this will give it away. What about... this is another trick table, but instead of flipping over, this one splits in half. Does that ring any bells? And something comes up between the table as it splits in half. And that's something that comes up is a car and a person next to that car.
Oh, shut up. Yes, that's The World Is Not Enough, isn't it?
Yes. So that's it when we first see R, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yes.
So that's, how many is that one? That's four. Any others?
They crop up when you go through it like that, don't they? I think that's all I can come up with. But he didn't give us an answer, did he? So we've left that open-ended. No. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's perfect. So if any of the listeners can think of any others apart from those four, let us know. And then we'll see if we can think of any others.
All right, good stuff. So you know what it's time for now, don't you, Chris?
Hit me with it.
It's time for the Guess the Quote round.
Bond. James Bond.
There it is. That's a very aggressive one this week. That was taking it to darker levels. You're Timmy D-ing it or Danieling it. I like it.
I was channeling that. Yeah, definitely.
So it was my quote last time, wasn't it?
It was. And I remember it was a single word quote because you love those.
I do like to get you with those. So here it is again. I'm about to perform it to you. I'm just going to get into my performance mode.
Okay.
Ingenious. Now, does that ring any bells? I'm going to do it for you.
It did. It rang bells last time, and it rang bells this time. And straight away, I thought villain. Can you say it again?
Okay. You might want to look at my hand as well. That might help you a little bit.
Oh, right. Okay.
Genius. Did that help you at all?
It might have done. Wait. It's there. Genius. Ah. I think I've got it. Is it Mr. Big in Live and Let Die when he's talking about the compressed air bullet thing on the shotgun?
Yes. I would call him Kananga by that point of the film, though.
Oh, but yes, Kananga, you're absolutely sorry. Right. You've sorry, got it. Yeah, Kananga. But it's Live and Let Die, yeah.
It is indeed, okay. Yes. When he shoots the little sofa that Whisper's sitting on and that's he has it, a little yeah. giggle about it. Yeah, oh,
yeah
absolutely.
Mr. Yeah, you're right. It should have been Kananga. Yeah, Mr. Big. But yeah. I knew the scene sort of thing. So
you got it.
Too bad.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Good stuff.
Cool. Okay, so I've got a quote for you this week.
All right.
Are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Okay, my quote for this week is, the coffin, it has your initials, JB.
Okay. Yes.
Does that ring any bells?
It does. It rings a very, very big bell. And I know exactly who it is, but the name of that character eludes me. But obviously, you're going to provide the answer next time. So you'll have to tune in to find out.
There we go.
Cool. So last time we had a listener quote from good old Steve Thorpe, didn't we? Should we have a listen to that one? See what it was.
Laters.
Yeah, mein Bühne hat ein Auto reserviert.
So I'm confident this particular scene came up in today's episode, if I remember correctly.
I think
as
it might have done.
One of my favourite cue scenes.
I think you could be right.
Well, almost immediately prior to that, I would say it's when Bond shows up to the rent-a-car place in Tomorrow Never Dies, and just before Quentin Quigley shows up to give him the business.
I think you're absolutely right. Should we see if we're right?
Let's have a listen, see what he's got to say.
All right, boys. Steve Thorpe here again. I had to stop myself from laughing from doing that quote because it's so funny. Okay, the answer to the quote, it was, of course, Pierce's James Bond in Tomorrow Never Dies. It's the scene where he arrives in Hamburg and he goes up to the Avis car rental place and he meets Q and gets his beamer. Anyway, still loving what you do. Keep it going, boys, and I'll see you soon. Out.
Lovely stuff. Always good to hear from Steve. And we got it. We pinned the tail on the donkey, didn't we?
Lovely. Well, it's all down to the brilliant performance there. Love it. Nice one, Steve.
Absolutely. Good stuff. Nice one.
Wicked.
So we have a new listener quote for this week, don't we, from Mr. James Drennan.
Hello, Tom and Chris. It's James here from Station U Ulster with, I guess, a quote for you. It's from one of my favourite films. See if you can have a guess. It is. You're just in time. Things are about to turn nasty.
Ah, what is that? That's going to drive me mad.
We got a whole week to think about it.
Yeah, I do.
Two weeks. Yeah.
I'm going to need those 2 weeks as well. All right. Excellent quote, Mr.
Drennan. Good question, James. Yeah.
I like those ones that you know, but you can't quite place. And that really gets your brain ticking over. Good stuff.
That's cool.
Excellent. So next up then, it's time for...
Who wrote the song for Live and Let Die? Who played Helga Branton? How did she die?
Okay, so this is Tommy Trivia, where I pick out a lovely Trivial Pursuit card and we go through all the different questions and see how many Tom can get right. And he's normally pretty good, aren't you, Tom? Normally pretty good.
Yes, I'm usually brilliant at this. One thing I should point out is it's the 007 Trivial Pursuit card, not just a random Trivial Pursuit card, because that would be a bit
amazing. Yes. And probably a lot harder as well. Yes. I just want to point out as well, from last time we did a Tommy Trivia, when we talked about there was a GoldenEye satellite weapon thing, and we had quite a few people say about the whole nuclear thing.
So just for anybody who didn't hear that, basically what it was on the card I questioned, it said that the GoldenEye weapon was a nuclear weapon, and I questioned that it wasn't a nuclear weapon because it looks a bit lasery, and I questioned whether they got it wrong. But then a lot of people stepped in with direct quotes from the film that says that it's a nuclear device set off from orbit that then causes an electromagnetic pulse. So I was mistaken. I would like to apologize for my incorrectness, and I hope I can serve you better moving forward.
Well, do you know what that just shows is that by putting on the ban of not watching these films since we started, I haven't seen GoldenEye for ages. In my mind, when the GoldenEye satellite, I saw a laser coming out of that satellite in my mind. That's how I thought it operated, but it isn't. Yeah. It's like, I think it makes a strange sound and then it just sort of blows up or whatever. But in my eye, in my mind, it was like, oh yeah, it's a laser satellite. Which is strange, but obviously if you haven't seen it for coming nearly 3 years, which is a long time, a hell of a long time. I'm going to go crazy when we finish all the reviews and just watch them all like mad. Okay, so we're on to Tommy Trivia. The first question is going to be about characters. Are you ready, Tom? Are you ready?
I am ready for it. Give it to me.
Question one, who plays Gobinder? Who plays Gobinder?
Who plays Gobinder?
This is a trick. That's player. A tricky one.
Yeah, I know him, obviously. And as soon as you tell me what his name is, I'm going to know. But his name is eluding me at this point.
We could come back to it if you want.
Yes, let's come back to it. Yeah.
All right, we'll come back to that one. Okay, question two. Who is Solange married to?
Demetrios.
Yes. Do you know his first name for an extra point? Or just a slap on the back?
That belongs to Mr. Demetrios. Is it... Damn it, they're catching me this week.
That's all right.
Is it?
You got Demetrios, no. So you get the answer. Yeah. Got listed here, Alex Demetrios.
Alex Demetrios. Do you know what? I was about to say that. Truthfully, I was going to say Alexander Demetrios.
It looked as if you were you're on point there. Yeah. Okay, so question three is about the vehicles. How does Bond arrive at the oil rig? Now, I'll Bond give you a arrive at the oil rig. Yeah, and this is obviously from Diamonds. What sort of form of transportation, I guess, is another way of saying it.
It's like a weird inflatable ball thing with points on it that he walks in. I have no idea what you would call one of those, but that's what
neither
it
do
is.
I. I'm actually going to check because I know you're right, but I'm going to check what the technical term is. Hang on. Walking inside a wave walker, apparently, is what it's called. A wave walker.
A wave walker. Interesting.
Yeah, now that's strange. I wouldn't have called, because there wasn't many waves, but I guess it's walking on water. But definitely get that. Okay, on to question four. How does M activate the locator card?
How does M activate the locator card?
I'll give you the film if you need it.
The locator card.
Would you like... If you need the film, I'll give you the film.
Yeah, I would need a little bit of extra help with that.
In The World Is Not Enough. How does M activate the locator card in The World Is Not Enough?
Of course. She takes the batteries out of the clock and hooks that up to it to give it
superb
a power source.
Superb, Tom. Excellent. I'm well chuffed. Great answer, that one. Okay, question five. Where in San Francisco does Chuck Lee pose as a vendor?
That would be Fisherman's Wharf, wouldn't it?
Yes! Good, man!
Nice.
You're flying back now. This is great. Okay, question six. In what year was You Only Live Twice first released?
In what year was You Only Live Twice first released? 1967.
Superb, Mr. Bond. Superb. So we just have one question to go back to. Who plays Gobinder or Gobinder? Depends on how you want to say it. It's a tricky one, this.
It's not tricky because I know it. I know that I know it.
Do you want the initials?
My brain has deceived me. Go on then.
KB.
Oh, fucking hell. Just do it. Tell me. Rip off the
his
plaster.
Name
go
is
on.
Kabir Bedi. Is it a name?
Is
Kabir
it?
Kabir Bedi.
Have I? Then
let me check. Let me check. Yeah, Kabir Bedi. Kabir Bedi.
Do you know what I've just realised? I have just realised something. Let me have a look at it.
Are you thinking of EJ or not?
Yes, I'm thinking of VJ. Oh, what a dick. I've been thinking this is a prime example of a question I have not listened to. Oh, what an idiot. I'm thinking
VJ.
Of course, and that's why I would know his name, because it's the same fucking name he has in the film. What a dick. Oh my God. VJ Armitages, who was I thinking of?
Yeah.
I wasn't thinking about Kabinda. What an idiot. All right.
But that was a tough, I'll tell you what, that round was a lot tougher than most of the rounds we've had before, wasn't it?
Definitely. It was a challenging one, that's for sure, yeah.
But he's superb. He got 5 out of 6 on that one. Brilliant stuff. Tommy, right, trivia cool. Done for this week.
Okay, so next up then, it's time for some...
It's the music cue.
Okay, so music cue for this week. Well, what we'll do first, we'll play the one from last week, and it was a good one, and I know it had you a little bit stumped, and I really think you will get it this time, but have a listen and see what you think, and obviously listeners at home, see if you can get it right as well. All right, what do you think then?
I don't know. I'm going to ask you some questions which you can provide a yes or no answer to, just to hopefully push me in the right direction.
Okay.
Is it from recent times?
I would say yes.
Is it from Skyfall?
I would say no.
Is it from Spectre?
Is that how you're going to play this game?
I'll
tell you what. Let me give you a clue. It's right towards the end of the film. Not the very last scene, but very close to being the last scene. Right towards the end of the film. See if that
is
helps.
Is it where he gives Dominic Green the oil in the desert?
It's when they're in the desert. Yes, indeed. Nice one.
Very nice.
Good man. Good man.
Do you know what my initial suspicion was? Was the scene from? Oh no, that actually wasn't the image it conjured up in my mind is that shot of all the coffins with all the
Union similar because you said last time it was mournful and it has got that sort of feeling, which I think relates to him being left in the desert, obviously at the end of that scene. So I guess that's a good link there. But yeah, no, you're right. Yeah. It has got that sort of feel to it. But yeah, superb, man. You got it in the end. Now, I'd be interested to see what you think of the music cue for this week. I'm hoping it might send you down one or two different potential avenues, or you might just get it straight away. Who knows? But let's play the new music cue for this week.
I know exactly what that is, and I know what you've tried to do. I know what you've tried to do, and I've got it. And I've turned the tables because I know what that is, because I've always thought that's one of my favourite things. Yes. All right,
You know what? There is 3 different edits I'm cut of that section. The first one would have been the hardest to get and sounded like the something else the most.
Yes.
The middle section was the middle, and if I had done it a little bit later, it would have given it away too much. And I went for the middle one. Maybe I should have gone for the very first edit, which would have been a little bit harder. But it's still the fact you got it is awesome. But we'll wait and see.
I see how you were trying to point me in one direction, but it was something else. I've seen right through it, and I would suspect JBR listener Ralph Lewandowski would probably be on the same scent that I particularly am. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
But good stuff. We'll obviously find out the answer to that next time and find out what cue that is. So the penultimate little session for today is what's the next line?
Pew, 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 pew.
Good stuff.
Okay.
Now, this little game is somewhat like the guest a quote round, but it's obviously the next line we're looking for. So, for example, if I said, do you expect me to talk? Chris's answer would be, no, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die. So, have we got the rules down? Everybody understand?
We have. All right, everyone understands. This is all good. Now, you went last week, and so it's my turn this week, which is good because I get nervous on these. So I'm glad it's the other way around today. But I think this is a semi-decent one. So the rules are, if you know it straight away, say it straight away, brilliant. But if you want me to say it a second time, great. You know, let it sink in the first time. I'll say it a second time and then see what you come back with. Okay, are you ready, Tom?
Yes,
so
I am.
So my what's the next line for today is, Pam, this is Q, my uncle. Uncle, this is Miss Kennedy, my cousin.
Uh,
Do you want me to say it again?
Give it to me again. Give it to me again. Yeah, okay. Come on.
Okay. Pam, this is Q, my uncle. Uncle, this is Miss Kennedy, my cousin.
It's not this, but it's something like, a pleasure to meet you, my dear. Something like that.
I think he says that after this line. I'm sure he says something like that after this line. But the line I've got is, I tell you what, you say that to me and then I'll say it back. Or actually, you might not remember.
I'll do it.
So it's Pam. It's Pam. This is Q, my uncle. Uncle, this is Miss Kennedy, my cousin. Ah, we must be related.
Ah, of course it is. Of course it is. Yes.
And then I think he follows up with pretty much what you just said afterwards. Yeah,
the clue was in the question, wasn't it? Because it was cousins and uncles, we must be related, of course.
Yeah, that's it.
Cool. Good one, man.
So we got our final quiz game of the day, which is...
Bond Girl Battle.
Oh, James.
I didn't recognise you with your clothes on.
Nice, I like it.
You really invested in your role there today. I liked it. You really went full on.
Maybe a bit too much.
So for any new initiates, this is where we pitch the Bond girls against each other to determine who the ultimate Bond girl is. We had Bond Celebrity Deathmatch, which went on for bloody ages. And this time, the new version of that is obviously the Bond girl battle. So let's have a little rundown of essentially who we've had so far in the previous rounds and what the current state of play is.
Okay, so in terms of winners that we've had, so we'll have three Bond girls to each round. In terms of winners that we've had so far, Pola Ivanova won the first round, Tracy won the second, Melina Havelock the third, Solitaire the fourth, Fiona Volpe the fifth. Oh, yes, please. Anya Massive won the last one, the sixth, and the seventh. And now we last week's one was a tie. We had another tie. We've had loads of ties. Last week's tie was between, I've got them right here, Miss Pussy Galore and Mayday. Two super strong characters there, aren't they? Two super strong characters.
Yes.
Now, so we couldn't decide, could we?
We debated it back and forth. We couldn't choose. Yeah. Obviously, they both have strengths in different areas and all that kind of stuff. And you could just come out and say, well, Mayday would wipe the floor with Pussy Galore because she's a lunatic. But Pussy has some very classic elements. It's not just a physical combat thing. No. It's like we would go by strength of character, how cool that character is, and all that kind of stuff. So we sent it out to the people. The people have spoken. The JBR family have spoken. And now we need to find out who came out on top.
Well, I have the results here, Tom. Now, would you like to know the percentages first?
Yes, please.
Okay, so the percentages I have here in front of me, second place has 31% and first place 69%. Now for me, that is a much bigger gap than I thought it was going to be.
Yes, that's I would call that a landslide victory, wouldn't you?
I definitely would. I was thinking more like 40s to 50s or something like that, but definitely not. Okay, now in second place we have Mayday, and the winner is Miss Pussy Galore. There we go.
Okay, so I would
say, well done, Pussy.
Like we said, Pussy Galore is the more classic character, isn't she? Yeah. We often reference the whole Red Grant versus Necros thing from the Bond Celebrity Deathmatch, whereby you might think Necros would come out on top because he's a bit buffer, but Red Grant is the more classic character. And I feel like that's probably what's won the day here. You can't argue with the classicness of Pussy Galore, can you?
Definitely not. And she's got the judo to back it up if she needs to. So she's got lots of experts. So well done, everyone. There's Pussy Galore going through to the next round.
Good stuff.
So I have here my Bond Girl Battle sombrero. And there it is. And now inside, I've got all these different cards of Spy Files cards and playing cards and all these different things, all with Bond girls on them. So I'm going to go through them. Tom's going to tell me to stop, and I'll pick out three different ones at a time, and then we'll see who we get. So
here we go. Stop.
Ooh, okay.
Stop.
I always look forward to this round and just to see who the hell we get.
Stop.
Okay, so there we go. There's still enough there for a good few rounds as well. So we are got So would you like to see who the first person is?
Yes,
please. The first person we have Every Stone Was Bought from France. Cute, isn't it? We have the lovely Corinne Dufour.
You love Corinne Dufour, don't you? You have a proper soft spot for a bit of Corinne.
Yeah, I think she's got a lovely face. She is beautiful. So Corinne Dufour is in round one. Lovely. Oh, mate. Look at this. Take a deep breath. Make it count. We have Camille Montes. And now she's beautiful, isn't she? Yes, she is lovely. Indeed. But a good character as well. Independent, out for revenge and everything like this. And the third person we have is, you'll never guess. We've only had her on the show today, Tom.
No way.
It's Rosie Carver.
How about that? There she is. Good stuff.
Amazing. Why so the three ones, we just as a recap, so we've got Corinne Dufour, we've got Camille Montes, and we have Rosie Carver. There she is. So what do we think? Should we start with Corinne?
Let's start with Corinne. So I have quite a clear thought of who's going to win this.
Yes, I do as well. And I think it's the same as yours.
Not because I love her. It has nothing to do with that. It's very firm reasons. So I would say Corinne, we don't see a great deal of her. She can fly a helicopter.
Well, we see her heart, Tom, and it's 18 carat.
I suppose we do. We do see that. She can fly a helicopter. She has a very beautiful face, as you say. What else has she got going for her? You're the Corinne lover, so let's hear from you first of all.
Well, she is a bit naive, isn't she? Mm-hmm. Like in terms of sort of potential downside. She obviously shows Bond the safe, so she's fallen for him. She takes advice from her mother on dates, but never learned to read, apparently. I think she's a good pilot, but we never see her in terms of fighting. That we never see that happen. She's pretty good at running away from those dogs, so at least initially. So in terms of like if she had to flee, she might be pretty handy, or fly out somewhere. But she's not, I wouldn't say she's what you'd call the classic Bond girl in terms of, she doesn't bring a lot to the party, and that's not being sort of nasty or anything. No. But she's kind of like a secondary character and a bit of a sacrificial lamb, I'd say.
Absolutely.
But still lovely to look at and does help Bond out and is kind-hearted, which is always nice. But I think it's the naivety which will probably bring her down a notch or two just because, you know, we want strong characters, don't we, really?
Yes. I feel the... Yes. Okay, so let's put Corinne to one side for a minute. Let's go to the other side of the fence and let's have a look at Rosie Carver.
Okay.
Now, I feel like Rosie Carver, she's not the best at spying, is she? She's quite sort of, you know, a little bit rough around the edges. She scares easily. You could just get a few chicken feathers sticking in
a little hat. Yeah,
and she's game over, really. That's
or a scarecrow.
You could play to the superstition super easy. That's going to be a weakness. Game over almost immediately. So I feel like, to be honest with you, I think it's fairly obvious who's going to go through today. So should we just announce it?
Well, let's say a plus points because I think we got to at least give some sort of mention.
Yeah.
Okay, so Camille. What can we say about Camille?
Just stunningly beautiful. I mean, good Lord above, yes.
She's got to be, what would you say, in terms of looks, I know we're not really allowed to do this, but would she be in your top five?
Yes, without a shadow of a doubt, in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
There is that. Yeah. The fact that she's got a mean streak in her, and she obviously had some bad stuff in her life, and she's hell bent on revenge. She's a bit like Melina Havelock in that sense, I guess. She's going to the ends of the earth to make that shit happen. So I think ultimately her weapon, certainly against me, would be the beauty. I'd just be like, do whatever you want, like just
I don't care, just kill me, but just make sure
kill me in a wonderful way, like suffocation or something. Just do that. I'll happily accept that. And she gets stuck in. So I'd say she's definitely the strongest character out of these three.
100%. Well, she's a tough cookie, man. You know, she's been through that fire and had all that burn on her back, and she managed to survive that. She's witnessed her family being killed and her mum raped, and so she's had to go through that. So she's got this burning desire to obviously get revenge. But also, she handles herself as well. You know, we see her with Bond with a gun at the end. You know, she's sort of he obviously gives a gun, but in an actual fight between them, I think she'd definitely come out on top anyway. But she's also got a really good story, really good backstory. She's a strong character, and she can't, you know, Bond. They don't get together, which is an interesting character point itself, isn't it? The fact that
now,
they don't.
Yes. If I was Daniel Craig, I would have said, hang on a minute, I've read the script. I know it's half done, and I know we're making it up as we go along, but we need to get some sort of gratuitous lovemaking scene in here, please. I'm going to quit. I'm going to walk off the set unless that happens. That would be my stipulation. Yeah.
I think it would probably be mine as well. Yeah, she's staying. Yeah. But yeah, completely agree. Camille Montez has to go through to the next round for a numerous number of reasons, but just have a little look at that and appreciate
it. Just have a little look at that. Oh yeah.
So there we are.
Yeah.
So Camille joins. No going to the audience this time. We're both 100% on that one. So Camille joins Pussy Glore as they go into the next round. So there
Beautiful
we are.
Stuff.
On girl battle done for this week.
There is. Okie dokie then. So obviously, as we announced last time, JBR is back to a weekly format. Obviously, we have the two kind of JBR shows as we always have done every 2 weeks. But then in the gaps, we have some different stuff going on these days. So obviously, last week was the first Music of Bond episode with Warren Ringham from Cue the Music. And next Friday, you can look forward to the very first in a series of audio documentaries from JBR listener Dan Gale. Now, the first one is kind of a bit feature length, you might say. He got stuck in and just kept going and made this amazing show all about the audiobooks of Bond, and it's called Tape Secret, and it's bloody amazing. So make sure you tune in for that next Friday. Again, you subscribe on your iTunes or subscribe on your podcast app and all that kind of stuff. Or if you watch on iTunes, subscribe on iTunes, and don't miss that, because he's gone to I don't even begin to understand the amount of effort he's gone to make this, with scripting certain things, finding samples of things, and putting it all together in the way he's done it is just really, really impressive. Well,
if people are out there thinking, okay, audiobooks, I've never really listened to them, I'm not into the audiobooks, all you have to do is listen to the first 2 or 3 minutes of Dan's thing, and you'll be hooked, and straight away you'll be like, this is amazing. And it really is. It is a piece of art and a great listen. So highly recommend next week's show.
Absolutely. So make sure you look out for that. Then the week after, we're going to be back with, I think we have another celebrity guest interview, don't we, Chris?
We might do. We might indeed. Now, I think, is there any? I think we might have to lay a couple of little hints. I know. When we laid the hints for Roger, we had quite a few guesses, didn't we? Mostly not quite right, but that might have been our own sort of making, which is quite cool. So I think we might have to throw a few hints out next week as well. What do you think?
Yeah, all I'm saying, Chris, is that episode is looking very good.
Oh, I like what you've done there. Amazing. That's the best one yet, Tom. That is the best one
yet. Thanks, man.
That's so good. Cool. Okay, so there we are. That's podcast episode 109 put to bed. We will be back next week with the Dan Gale audiobook episode. Mm-hmm. And my name is Chris Wright.
And I've been Tom Sears. So tune in for Dan Gale next week, and we'll see you the week after that. See ya. Bye.
Bye.